While Brahm is collecting the rest of the money and the funds, I would like to welcome you to the College of Complexes. My name is Tim. I'm just, me and my friend Paul are going to be helping out with video and audio for the speaker tonight.
Beautiful paragraph.
I'd like to welcome all of you to the college tonight. Then Brahm will be taking over from me as our master of ceremonies. I would just like to brief you on a couple of rules about the college. Number one is one hole at a time, and the second rule is no personal attacks. I know it's a little bit early, but we'd like to get started right away, and we'll start with announcements. When our speaker will speak, there'll be a question and answer session, and after the question and answer session, there'll be the infamous rebuttals. Questions usually last until about 10 o'clock, and then we'll close our rebuttal period. We won't time each speaker within a lot of times, but Brahm will explain more after the announcement period. Well, Brahm is still collecting money. I would now like to introduce our speaker, Larry Spivack. If you're ready, Larry.
Hey.
Let's give him a rounding round of applause. And
thank you very much. So how many languages do we have to salute and l'chaim and steniyasu and what else? You know them all. To us. Thank you for inviting me, or did I invite myself? I can't remember now how this went. College of Complexes. I've been in Chicago area my entire life, and I am happy to finally be here. I see a few familiar faces, a few unfamiliar faces that I hope will be friendly. I want to recognize a local author who we've sold some books for, who is sitting over here. His name is Peter Perro. Peter, maybe everybody knows you, but Peter's books on Italians and Chicago and the book, are you still working on the Pilsen book or is that done?
The Pilsen book's done and I presented it to these victims.
Oh, okay.
1 year ago.
I know. So we like Peter a lot. So I have a couple of other friends in the audience, but I will try to make some sense of this complex thing for the College of Complexes. Excuse me. I do have a number of commercials, though. How could I not? Usually you wait to the end. Can you hear me okay? Yeah. So, my name's Larry Spivack. I wear a couple of hats. One hat is that I am regional director with the American Federation of State, County, Municipal Employees. We're the bad guys. You know, we're the ones that are trying to steal from the public trough so that the poor banks and the corporations and have less money. So, you know, the fact that a public employee's pension on average in Illinois is $32,000 a year without Social Security, I mean, that's like a crime against humanity, isn't it?
Yes.
I mean, just think about it. People have worked 35 years and they're bringing in $32,000 a year, and the corporate agenda is basically to destroy that. Now, they already achieved that in the private sector, as you know. I didn't come here to give an entire lecture about the labor economics, but that's where this always goes, because ultimately this is about a question of how do we change society. I am not just going to hopefully present a few slides about people who contributed greatly, but provoke some discussion about how we change society and what, in my own personal belief, is the best way to go about it, which I'm sure may or may not challenge some of yours. I would, I've been in the world of labor for my entire adult life, which means my entire adult life puts me at about 33, 34 years of starting out as a teacher, and then in 1984, well, I was a local rank and file officer at a union that asked me represented, and then met people like a guy here, Rich Berg. Rich, raise your hand. We were organizers together. For some reason, though, his hair didn't turn gray and he didn't lose it. He looks the same he did 30 or 28 years ago. I don't understand this. There's something wrong. But Rich works for us again in the Rockford area, and he's I was so happy. He was president of the Teamsters Local 743 and challenged Jimmy Hoffa and won, but unfortunately Jimmy Hoffa has stolen his office, so he came to work for us. So, but anyway, that being said, I want to pose some questions as I go through some labor history. I do a lot of presentations as president of the Illinois Labor History Society. And if it would be, if you were a typical American, you wouldn't have a clue about this. You wouldn't have a clue what this is. Anybody know what this is? Raise your hand. Hey, at least a quarter of you. The most important labor site in the world. I mention it because the Illinois Labor History Society founded in 1969 with people like Studs Terkel, Les O'Rear, Bill Adelman, and others. Joe Jacobs thought that honoring the monument that represents the reason that workers around the world, billions of workers, celebrate a holiday, except in the United States, the reason that movements across the world were spawned to try to gain an even playing field in the world of work because of the martyrs of Haymarket, because in 1889, after the two years after the hanging of these martyrs, for no reason other than their ideas, isn't that what the College of Complexes is about, is to promote ideas and free thinking? Well, that caused these men to be hanged and to try to scare off workers from organizing, and hence a holiday known as International Labor Day, or May Day, was spawned in Paris, France in 1889, saying that from here on May 1st should be a day of labor celebration around the world. But of course, 99% of us, ironically, don't know what it is, but I got a feeling the 1% do. So think about that irony. And why is it that the 1% know about it and the 99% don't? I will just leave that as a question, as one that somebody will want to try and answer later. In terms of my commercial, I have a couple of items that I want to share with you. Everything is going to be discounted because this is the College of Complexes. And I know that you are probably only part of the 99%. Mostly the 1% doesn't buy our stuff anyway. But this t-shirt, $20 t-shirt, I will make available for 10. I have a handful of them behind here. This book, when we restored the Haymarket Monument after its dedication the day before the pardon of the martyrs in 1893, we are the deed holder. Do you understand the important? This is why I'm so proud. The Illinois Labor History Society is the deed holder of this monument. We are the custodian. It's a National Historic Landmark, which few people don't like that idea, but I think it's a great idea. But we just restored it. It cost us $34,000. The wreath is back. We're going to finish the backside where there's a little plaque that was there that was stolen. Some of you may have been at May 1st celebration in Forest Park, and this monument again represents the reason that billions of workers have organized in around the world over the years, over the last 125 years. So this I'll sell for $5. This is a lot of new people in it because we kept doing research in the last 20 years and keep finding all kinds of people. This grave sites are whose ashes were there, and so it's all listed in here when you come. And if you're not on one of our official tours and you do your own, you can know where to look. We do all kinds of programs. I'm going to go through a few of them. And, excuse me. If you don't have a pen, it shouldn't be hard to remember IllinoisLaborHistory.org. IllinoisLaborHistory.org, IllinoisLaborHistory.org. That's the website where you can buy books. Or you could come to our office for the next month or so, which I want to tell you about. And buy books like this one, which is probably the best new survey of labor history, I think. Philip Gray's book, There is Power in the Union, and we're selling it in paperback now, so it's cheap. It's a great survey. It's a great way to tell the story of labor in America. There hasn't been as good a labor history book on the history of labor that takes us from the beginning to now, and I highly recommend it. We sell DVDs, and now I want to tell you about a few events, and then we will begin the program, the official program, the one that you really came for. First of all, just keep in mind some dates. April 28th, we'll be doing a program at the the Jane Addams Hell House to celebrate a new book by Louise Knight on Jane Addams, who I'll probably mention a little bit more. I'll be there April 28th at Hell House. May 1st this year, the plan is at the Haymarket Square downtown. Every year since 2004, after 30 years of work, the Labor History Society, in conjunction with other people, finally got a statue at the most important, one of the most important events of our last 125 years took place, the Haymarket tragedy. There is now a monument there. It's displayed in Randolph. We worked for 30 years to get something there. And part of the goal and what we do every year is we have a plaque dedicated from some labor organization, usually an international one, because the whole purpose of International Labor Day is to celebrate international labor and solidarity, which I will argue is the only basis in which we now are going to be able to change the world in the way that most in this room would want. And we haven't quite achieved that solidarity, but people from around the world have been dedicating plaques for the last 7 years, and this year our expectation, it's not totally confirmed, but it's mostly confirmed, the COSATU, the Coalition of African South Trade Unionists, who are on strike across the country right now, are supposed to come and dedicate a plaque. That's May 1st, that'll be probably late morning. May 12th, we are sponsoring at Union Station for National Train Day. I noticed the train club is here. Pullman Porter's event because of the something that we care a lot about. I'm going to talk a little bit more about the Porters. May 16th, we're co-sponsoring the birthday of Studs Terkel, who was one of the founders of the Illinois Labor History Society, at the Newberry Library. That evening, you'll see it. It's on the web. Newberry Library, Studs Terkel. It's going to be an interesting free event with food and with speakers and celebration and music. 100th birthday of Studs Terkel. There's going to be a lot of Studs events this year, actually. May 19th, of course, is going to be the best concert of the last 10 years. This land is our land. These are all out there, and it does cost money. It's going to be at the Metro. Tickets are going fast, and you'll see that it includes Tom Morello, the Plasmatics, Holly Neer, Bucky Hawker, and John Langford, Kevin Koble, Tashi Reagan. Some of you may know some of these folks. Del Viento. It's a diverse group. Everybody who's been informed by Woody Guthrie, because it's his 100th birthday this year. And so you don't want to miss this concert, and tickets are on sale to the public starting yesterday. If you're a person that doesn't like to stand, and you feel that you want to go, and you can't get a ticket, you might want to contact me because I might be able to get you a ticket where you can sit, but I can't guarantee it. So, and then May 26th is the 75th anniversary of what we call the Memorial Day Massacre, which was the Little Steel Strike, of which I'm probably not going to be able to show the video, but we have the exclusive rights, the Labor History Society, to the Paramount newsreel that was shot that showed the police attacking the workers when they surrounded the workers who were doing a peaceful picket to celebrate trying to get recognition of Republic Steel on the South Side in 1937. I'm going to talk a little bit more about anniversaries because this was billed as an anniversary of labor, gazillions of labor history events, but that was just a way to get you in the door so that I can espouse my seditious ideas. So I want to read something. The idea of less restriction and more liberty and a confiding trust in nature is equal to her work is permeating all modern thought. Of all the modern delusions, the ballot has certainly been the greatest. The fact is, money and not votes is what rules the people. Passivity while slavery is stealing over us is a crime. When labor is no longer for sale, society will produce free men and women who will think free, act free, and be free. Some of you may have seen the cover of the book. Who wants to guess who that is, who didn't see the cover of the book? It's Lucy Parsons, our very own. And I won't spend too much time on each individual, but Lucy Parsons Park has yet to be dedicated in the Labor History Society. It's at 4800 West Belmont. This was actually, believe it or not, 120 years. She dies in 1942, 125 years after, or 120 years after Haymarket, and the city of Chicago is arguing that naming a park after Lucy Parsons is a problem. So the point is, the power of these events of 1886 are so powerful that it took us till 2004 to get a monument in Haymarket Square. And that May 1st is not a holiday in this country, while it is in virtually every country, officially or unofficially. So just think about the power of what those ideas represented. And when the Haymarket took place, the state's attorney, Grinnell, said, he goes, these men are no more guilty than the rest of you. They are guilty for, you must convict them because of their ideas. And that's why we have the Kellogg complexes, to know that if we have ideas, those ideas are more powerful. The silence that you'll see on the words on the monument, I'll get to that, because we all know sometimes that it's what's between the spaces. It's the silence, it's the ideas that move people. The Arab Spring, in many ways, was about that. I'm talking about collective action in this. I'm talking about many contradictions. I'm going to be talking about, I think, our paradoxes in our society, because that's just, to me, reality, and we have to grapple with those. I'd like to begin with a very important video demonstrating what some people actually have to live like.
Certified public accountants.
Thank you.
Some of you laughed. I showed this to a bunch of college students at Northern a month ago. They didn't get it.
They will soon enough.
Well, the dignity of labor, right? The indignity that people suffer every single day around the world and in the United States, but that most of us somehow seem to ignore, even though most of us, if we're employed, work and share that in common. But I like to just show what it might be like to be in the other, somebody else's shoes. Maybe one day some of those folks will understand what it means to be a day laborer, to be unorganized.
Larry, let me add something like that.
Please do.
That I was on Fullerton Avenue Monday at a Mexican restaurant, and there was an Anglo mom, for lack of a better word, walking her kid around, begging from table to table. And the last time I saw that was in Mexico, where in the tourist restaurants, Mexican workers were walking from table to table, although they had something to sell, you know, flowers. And I thought, it's come home. Now, how ironic, I'm sitting in a Mexican restaurant, and there's a blonde-haired mom walking her child around trying to sell candy bars. And it's global.
It is global. Global has come home to the United States in a way that why we talk about international labor solidarity, not in abstract terms anymore, and not just a few people that thought that they read Marx at some point in their life. I want to tell you about an indignity of my organization is suffering, because I would like to believe that the Illinois Labor History Society serves an incredibly important function as the custodian of the world's most important labor site. Maybe sounds like hyperbole to some of you, but I don't think that's understated, because everybody around the world knows, except in the United States, why that site is there, who is conscious at least, and celebrates May Day consciously. Last week, Harris Bank, who took over the building, gave us a 30-day termination notice and is kicking us out. We're not going. Can I use foul language in this, or would this offend anybody? It is on video. Well, those motherfuckers at Harris Bank are going to pay a price. Now, if each of you will call Harris Bank on Monday and ask for Tom Bessler and just say, Tom, you are not going to kick out the Illinois Labor History Society. We do have to leave because the building is being redeveloped by Roosevelt University, by DePaul. It's been sold to a developer, but we have a lease, and they're violating the terms of the lease. This is going to cost us thousands and thousands of dollars, which we don't have, which is one reason that I hope that you'll buy books and you'll help us and you'll join. And I have membership cards here, because there shouldn't be a person who walks out of here. I have not done my job, and I should step down as president if I can't convince five people in this room to join the Labor History Society who do not belong, with $30 a year. And this is how we exist. We are a society, we're a club, we're a league, whatever you want to call it, but you become an owner of that monument too, which you would be anyways, the People's Monument. So anyway, we're taking on the bank. We're going to win this fight, and not only are we going to win this fight, we are going to get Harris Bank to pay such a price, one, because they're sending it to their lawyer, I sent it to a lawyer, because that's what you got to do. And the moment they're, one of the biggest law firms in the city opens up that file, which they deploy Harris Bank, they're going to spend more money opening the file than they would if they would just give us the 3 or 4 months that we need to be able to move. So, do call Harris Bank on Monday if you wish. I won't object. I have a slideshow. I'm not going to show every slide. I'm going to jump through a number of things because we're already I know you guys probably want to have some discussion. So I like to talk about labor history because one, it is what I believe telling that story. Like anybody whose story hasn't been told, I think it's like when people discover telling one's personal story, one's individual story, one's collective story, gives one a sense of power. And most workers have no sense that they actually have a history that has transformed society in ways that wouldn't be here doing what we do and living the lives that we live if we at least consider ourselves part of a so-called middle class, you know, that grew and grew once labor was able to achieve a certain modicum of power, both as an institution and as a, I would say labor is the only mediating institution in society that could create a quality of life that we ideally would all like to see. Some people believe it's the church, and in some cases the church does that. But between the church and labor, those are really the only two large organized mediating institutions in our society that have that kind of power to help people be together. I say the church of whatever particular faith people may or may not belong to, but in terms of organization. I'm a firm believer in organization. And there I could talk about the paradox and the contradiction of how organization is also our worst enemy, but some people know that too. This is not DePaul University, but you know, most people in this country don't realize that most white people came to this country as indentured servants. And the difference, though, between being white and black, you know, the social construction that there are races, is really that white people were, of course, able to free themselves and blend in, whereas the 400 years of the Middle Passage and slavery, and it was different for African Americans. And I always talk about this, and in some cases it confuses people, because in the labor history slideshow, and I talk a lot about race, but I don't see how you can be an American and not talk about race. I don't see how you could be an American and not understand that free labor built this society, and that it's through that free labor that spawned the idea that I just read from Lucy Parsons, who was African American, part Mexican, possibly partly Native American, and married to a white man who was a Confederate soldier originally. She understood that. The labor movement in the beginning of industrialization understood, because of slavery in this country, that the notion that you create wealth for people and you don't get paid the value of what you do. What could be more unjust? And so that's why the term wage slavery started coming about. And it's not to minimize the meaning of slavery, but it's to make the association that people give their labor. You know, much about the Revolutionary War in this country and the fight for independence was about that. The rope workers were part of that first battle, you know, in the 1750s where the British were shooting, I forget what they were called, rope, whatever they were called that made rope. And, you know, this whole concept of immigration is incredible because the story just keeps repeating itself over and over again. But I want to take you through this early part of industrialization and talk about what was happening, because in Chicago is really the center of industrial activity by the 1860s and 1870s and 80s in America, because for all the reasons, you know, the city of Big Shoulders and where we are and so on. It was funny, though, that the what are they called? The people who went out and surveyed from the federal government.
No.
I must be over 40 now. I can't remember.
Coastal Geologic Survey.
All of a sudden, I can't think of it. They said nobody should ever build a city in Chicago because it's a swamp. And so that notion actually gave rise to some industries, which is why George Pullman became a billionaire in his way. But the Civil War, when people came back from the Civil War, they discovered that the men, of course, didn't discover, they knew this, that their wages had been replaced by child labor. Somebody ought to be working in these burgeoning factories. And so there was the intense organization around the idea of an eight-hour day movement that began in the 1860s after the Civil War got a lot of momentum. There were even laws passed about eight-hour days, but they were never enforced. It's kind of like labor legislation in America. It's rarely enforced, even though we have laws. And so That's another story about why do we pass laws that aren't enforced, or why is it that we don't enforce the laws that we pass. I would argue again that it's about the idea that citizens have to be engaged in a process that they think somebody else should take care of, which suggests the reason why so many unions no longer have power, because workers, of course, abrogated their own responsibility, and unions, they thought they were buying an insurance policy rather than being part of an organization that was a collective organization. Anyway, the issue of child labor, of women in the labor movement who got to be paid one-fourth, one-fifth, one-tenth the wage of a man, it's the same thing as paying Mexican workers $7 a day instead of $8.15 an hour, but now the $7 a day that the minimum wage in Mexico, or $8 a day, is way too much to pay, so you can pay 50 cents an hour in China, but that mostly they'll find ways to pay them 25 cents an hour. Why wouldn't you if you're trying to make money? And since capitalism is really a divine right of our society, isn't it? I mean, what other system should exist? I mean, it's individual, it's libertarian, it's a natural law granted from above that we should be able to make as much as we want. I mean, and why should it be regulated? So obviously, we have to go to China because it's cheaper. Why would you make something in Mexico if you could make it cheaper in China? So anyway, the Knights of Labor were an organization some of you have heard about. I go on and on about it. This is a 12-hour class, by the way. We're going to do it another half hour. So, but I like the Knights of Labor because Terence Powderly and other people in the Knights actually espoused the idea of a kind of a non-racist, inclusional organization as one of the first major national labor organizations. But later on, the Knights of Labor lost some of, there were, like always, there's competing interests and different ideas about how you organize society, how you organize politics. But I like to think about it in terms of an evolution, a process. Of course, we know that period of industrialization brought millions and tens of millions of people to America thinking that the land of milk and honey and gold-paved streets was around the corner. But by the 1870s, the Chicago fire is an interesting event for us because in 1871, after the fire, all this money was collected to donate to all those people who lost their houses. But I know this will shock you. I know it's surprising. But the corporations that were running the trust used the several million dollars of that donated money as an interest-free loan. I know. But so demonstrations ensued, and this outraged so many people. People started talking about we should have a working man's party. There was an international working man's party, and some people said the ballot box doesn't work; it's corrupt. I know that's shocking, especially if you're from Chicago again. But 1870s, this period of industrialization is incredible because just like in England and in Germany and in America. These boom-bust cycles that we experience constantly, it's the nature of the system. You're going to have boom, you're going to have bust. Boom for a few people, bust for everybody. And there was a lot of organizing. But a lot of people don't realize that in 1877, there was this national railroad strike across, that swept across the country beginning, Peter, I can't remember, is it like in, it's in the spring in Virginia, West Virginia, and it spreads across the country. Probably the closest thing this country ever had to a workers' revolution. I mean, that's how this event is so powerful. You have the Battle of Viaduct in Chicago, where 30 to 60 workers are killed at 13th in Halstead, just past the Hull House and right before you go into the Pilsen neighborhood. This illustration tries to represent, but it's those kinds of events that created the Law and Order League, the George Pullmans and the Marshall Fields and the McCormicks and people like that who said, we got to have an armory to defend the rich. We have to have a National Guard to defend the rich. I mean, this is safety from the mob, right? So this is our history. This is what's happening, and so this struggle of, if I can say it in this room, capital and labor, this class struggle is now very pitched in the 1870s. and gives rise to all kinds of other organizations. And unions are growing by leaps and bounds, not so much on a national basis, because union people were organizing, you know, in their own factories. You know, you'd have 20 unions in a factory at that time. But people like August Spies, people like Elbert Parsons, these are heroes, martyrs of the reason that we have what we have today. People like Lucy Parsons, who was banned from speaking in Chicago and said, okay, I can't speak in Chicago, then since I could float on a barge on the Chicago River, I can speak to workers along the Chicago River. That's what she did. And I would love to spend time talking more about Lucy Parsons. And one of the things that I'm trying to do is incorporate more of the stories of women into the story of labor, because, you know, the traditional thinking is always this blue-collar industrial thing. But in fact, I could spend, there is no way you cannot talk about the role of women in building labor reform and change in terms of all the most important events, and Lucy Parsons was there for many of them. You know, we still, the Chicago Tribune, by the way, finally printed a letter of mine last Sunday, but it wasn't that controversial, but that's the McCormick family that owned the Tribune that is dedicated to this day to trying to stifle the voice of workers. I speak from firsthand experience because I was spent an hour on the phone with the editorial board the other day talking about the Department of Children and Family Services. But anyway, that's my hat as a union representative. So the problem, I don't want to tell the whole story of Haymarket. I think many of you know it. You're going to get the book anyway and go on the tour. So, but what you have to know is that the rally that was called for at Haymarket Square is the result of August Spies watching workers gunned down for protesting McCormick's lockout of the workers in, on May 4th of 1886. Sorry?
No.
Oh, okay. Was the reason that a rally, I said May 4th, the event took place on May 3rd. The call for the event in Haymarket Square was the evening of May 4th to protest the police brutality. But if you read the monument, it really is true. It's not. It's about the idea of the right of people under our Constitution to associate, freely associate. I mean, that is a revolutionary idea in some ways. I mean, there's a lot about our American history that Rick Santorum and Romney and many others don't seem to understand, that there were some revolutionary ideas built into that Bill of Rights and Constitution, namely being the separation of church and state and the right to freely associate and peaceably assemble. And that's what this was, this event on May 4th, 1886. But here's, you know, the whole frame up of the this event is amazing, because you look at the two flyers. Now, I know there are some people that like to call themselves anarchists, and they like to argue and say, they were anarchists, and they were bomb throwers, and that was a good thing, and blah, blah, blah. But the issue, that's true. I mean, that's why people deface our monument. You know, they put black on it, and they're nihilists. They call themselves anarchists. They have no clue what anarchism is. Anarchism is about cooperation. Anarchism is about a utopian society where people work together to create a better good. You know, yes, without government, but whatever the case may be, to people that are calling themselves anarchists so often, I think are really misguided, and I call them nihilists, and they're just, you know, they got emotional problems and like to disrupt things. But I know not everybody's that way, and there are good, I got to throw a few generalizations out there. But you notice this, the thing I'm circling on this slide is, that's the thing, that flyer was not distributed, the one that I just circled in blue. The flyer that was distributed is the one on the right, because August Spies said to Adolf Fischer, who printed the first leaflet, I'm not going to speak at a rally that says working men come in full force, arm yourselves and appear in full force. You know, there's going to be a peaceable rally and we're going to make fiery speeches about not letting, you know, the state. When I talk about police brutality, the police were just simply merely tools of McCormick and Field and Pullman and Armour and Swift, and, you know, even the mayor of Chicago, Carter Harrison, was a halfway decent guy. He was a halfway decent guy, but at that time. But anyway, the flyer was thrown in the wastebasket, but when the police raided Arbiter Zeitung Hall, that's the one they picked out so that they could show that there was a conspiracy among other made-up things and paid-off people. But Samuel Fielden, who was the lay minister, Methodist lay minister, a lot of people don't know this story. It's really ironic. He was actually a teamster for hire. The day of the rally, the bombing where seven police shot each other and gunned down a bunch of workers because the bomb was thrown, because the police were the ones that were armed, not the workers. He was at Forest Home Cemetery delivering a load of stone. And it's just so, I think that's so, you know, all these little ironic things in history, these little coincidences. And then here he is, the last speaker of the night at the Haymarket Rally. And at the moment that he is just about to finish on this day when 2,500 people showed up instead of 20,000 because it was a typical miserable May 4th of in Chicago. But there were 176 policemen and said, Blackjack Bonfield at the helm, demanding that they disperse the name of the people. And Samuel Fielden says, but this is a peaceable rally. And at that very moment, the bomb is thrown, and you know the story, and nobody knows who threw it, but people got framed. They picked out eight people, eight activists. So probably many of us in this room would have been arrested the next day because martial law was declared, because now there was a pretext to destroy this growing labor movement. So this Red Scare, as I like to call it, becomes the trial of the century, and I am spending more time on the Haymarket than I wanted to, but it's just such a great story. Why there aren't, like, actual, you know, they made the movie Reds with, Diane Keaton and Maureen O'Sullivan and Warren Beatty. We ought to have a movie on Haymarket, right? A Hollywood movie?
Yep.
Well, imagine how truthful they would tell it, though. So, but the trial is incredible. You know that. It's a bullshit trial. It's a kangaroo court. I'm not going to go through the whole thing because I want to move on and I want to get to some questions. But obviously, you know, the notion of justice. It was judicial murder. We know that. That's why Clarence Darrow was able to convince, ultimately, these are the martyrs that I'm Fisher, Speeds, Parsons, and George Engel. You know, most of the guys that were arrested weren't even there. But you can read the transcripts. The transcripts are great. The best part about the transcripts of the trial is that the was voir dire of the my French isn't very good, so somebody who knows French can tell me how to say voir dire. I don't know. It's, you know, when they interview the potential jurors. And, you know, there was a special bailiff appointed by Judge Geary who then made sure that they could only have people who would be biased. It's in the transcript. They're asked, can you be unbiased? No. Hey, great, you're on the jury. I mean, that's pretty much how it goes. So you should read some of the stories. They're incredible. I sometimes when I do presentations, I have musicians and we sing songs, and I always like that this is a good time for the international, because this is when we gave birth to the idea of an international labor movement, I think. And then, you know, the police statue. Here's another interesting irony, because the police statue was there, is still, you know, now it's, I have a picture on my iPhone of on the back of it. It says the police headquarters in Michigan in 35th, and, you know, it talks about how, you know, these, hey, first of all, we represent police officers. I'm not anti-law enforcement, but obviously we know the role of law enforcement in society. And at that time especially, it was quite interesting. And the plaque there honors the police, you know, kind of being attacked by the workers, which of course is as far from the truth as can be. I mean, Governor Altgeld understood that, then he lost, could never run again. But the police statue, another interesting irony is that the guy who posed as the police officer a year or two later is thrown off the police force for drunkenness and embezzlement. So, I just think it's funny. And there's our statue at Haymarket Square that we got in 2004, which I think is an interesting piece. And we have, if you haven't been there, on the street side, and last year Labor History Society dedicated a plaque. I hope Kosatu is this year. Because we have people, we have the Japanese organization, the Colombians were the first international organization to dedicate a plaque. They actually, this is the difference between what Haymarket means. before the dedication of the plaque, I was giving a tour to, I think it was a group of teachers, and I was there, and this guy is translating the two young Latino men, and they're around the Haymarket, and they were trying to talk to me in Spanish, and I know, you know, like four words. I'm an American, right? I only speak English, and not that well, not very good English, right? You know, it's like everybody else is multilingual in the world. But, and I said, what's going on? Well, they want something, because I was giving a tour, and I had little artifacts, little books. They want something about the Haymarket. They just want it. I had a little postcard, the names of the martyrs. And I go, well, why are they here? And the guy, we happened to be a priest, a pastor, a reverend at a Methodist church, who some of you may know, the Reverend Dan Dale, said, well, they fled Colombia. You know, they're part of the thousands of trade unions that are being murdered every year. It's not quite as bad now, but, you know, probably 10,000 trade unions. Anybody organizing a union in Colombia was murdered. Trade unionists know about Haymarket. I go, well, why are they here today? He goes, well, before they came for sanctuary, the church is the first place in America they wanted to come to. Now, think about the power of that. The people from Colombia, trade unionists, young men who are fleeing for their lives want to come to the Haymarket, and they know about it. And nobody in America knows about it. I was so moved by that I felt like this is why I'm dedicating my life to this. You know, other people that really dedicate their lives. And what am I doing? You know, I'm privileged. I got white skin. I make middle class income. I do work I love to do. And people are dying for, you know, so I like to at least tell a story and help encourage others to want to participate. So anyway, the statue now has, and I'm fortunate I didn't import the new slide because we now have the wreath there that we did last year. And we had about 2,000 people show up at the cemetery to support the restoration. That was the old wreath, but it was stolen in the 90s, and now we have a new one that looks just like it. And we have a mold made, so if it ever gets stolen again, it won't cost us $30,000. I was just showing you Emma Goldman, because you know Emma Goldman, another great hero, another great leader for many issues. Her site is there, and I have reason to believe that the Labor History Society is also the holder of her monument, since we were given the papers by, how in the world, this is like I talk about this every day, but just go there and look at the graves. So I would, in another show, I would talk about Emma Goldman. But, you know, this period after the Haymarket, there's, you know, it kind of stifles the ability to organize because people are afraid. You know, the pretext to crush the labor movement through the Haymarket made everybody afraid. It's the way it works today. If you try to organize a union, you get fired or you get deported, and then you don't have the union, because that's America. Then they would just kill you, like they do in Colombia. So, and many people did die. You know about the Homestead Steel Strike of 1892, and of course this is Sam Gompers. But I mention him because I think that one of the problems I have with people who call themselves progressive sometimes, or leftists or whatever, is they love, we all do, to generalize. And so many people always say, the problem with labor movement history is that a guy like Sam Gompers was president, and he was just a racist, and he was just into craft unionism. But the record is much more complex than that. It is so much more complex than that. And I think it's like the way people criticize certain politicians who may not take a position you like, but they have reasons, there's context to what they do. Yes, it's true that Sam Gompers started the union label working in the cigar shop because Chinese immigrants were coming in and they were non-union and they were undercutting the wages in San Francisco. I don't mean individually, but the companies were able to undercut the wages. And so that the union label came about and Sam Gompers was part of that. But you can attribute all kinds of things people say out of context. And now we have Gompers Park in Chicago, and I'm proud of it. I'm proud of what he did. I also disagree with a lot of things that Sam Gompers said and did. Hey, I'm proud of Richard Trumka, and I disagree with a lot of things that he does. So, you know, that's society, right? We debate it, and we try to move people to a position that we can agree on to do the right thing. Eugene Debs. He ran for president and won a million votes on the Socialist Party ticket, but he's the guy that, who convinced Eugene Debs to get the American Railway Workers Union to support the Pullman workers who went on strike in 1894? 18-year-old Jenny Curtis gave a speech. By the way, there's a plaque on her house in Pullman, and we give tours there too. But, you know, she is, here an 18-year-old girl has the ability to sway a couple thousand men to support the strike and eventually create the American Railway Workers Union as the union for the Pullman workers. And there is our friend George Pullman, who had so many rebars put across the grave, so when they poured the concrete, people wouldn't tear his exhumed body and kill him 17 times over. Even the rich people hated George Pullman. And there's another guy, he was just a marketing genius, and I love to tell the Pullman story, and we are now. And you need to go on the web because we are supporting national park status for Pullman. There's a chance this is going to happen, national park status. It's a state park right now, and we want to, you know, it's a long story about what's happened there, but you need to go to Pullman if you haven't been there. So I could tell you story after story about our hero, Mother Jones, but here's... Now there's new controversy about her, by the way. Mother Jones, now the record is beginning to suggest that she wasn't born in 1830, but in 1837. And the only reason that that's troubling is that it's fun to say that she was 100 years old. I was going to show a video of her right before she died at 100, because it's the only movie of her, and where she's speaking, and she says, they call me a red, they call me a Bolshevik, they call me a troublemaker. Well, I admit to being all those things, because whatever it is, that it's labor that's going to change the world or something like that. You know, there she is, 100, or maybe she's 98 or 2, who knows. But, you know, it wasn't until she was in her 60s when she became really a full-fledged activist. So, but Mother Jones, what does she bring to the table? She brings the idea that free labor by children working in the mines and in the factories is a crime against humanity. And you know, one of the first strikes in this country that's a mass walkout is in 1837. Children working in a silk factory. It was, I think it was the Patterson, New Jersey, but it's not the famous Patterson strike of the 1890s. But in the 1830s, here's my point. You guys, this won't be alarming, but when I talk about, to like say college students who people grow up with ideas that they think things are supposed to be the way they are. In 1837, we as a society thought it was okay, either by necessity, but it wasn't considered a human right, except for a few, to the children 10 years old could be working 10 hours in a factory. And the children demanded that children under 11 shouldn't have to work more than a 10-hour day. That's what the children walked out about. Society accepted that. Now, we wouldn't accept that. Even sort of like goofy far-right wing people today would say that's probably a bad idea, except for Newt Gingrich. So what I believe is that we have to challenge people's preconceived notions about what we think is okay. And that's our job as activists, because if it was okay for that, then certainly it was okay to have black people as chattel, right? We know that there were millions of people who thought that was okay. Now, most people would say it's preposterous, but they still think it's okay that you could have deport people because they're brought here by rich corporations, but they're undocumented and that they should be separated from their children. I mean, you know, these are ideas. Some people, you know, and we could go on and on about the social issues and the culture wars, right? We got to challenge. Every day we got to challenge people's thinking, and Mother Jones did that. Mother Jones did it, and she marched, and she brought the face of children to the public, and it was organized labor, or efforts of organized labor with her and others to create public schools. Why should we have children in factories undercutting our wages? You know, you might say it was the narrow interest of labor in that sense, but there were a lot of people who it was also a, you know, a great human rights concern that these boys, her minor angels, who she's buried with, that's her march on Teddy Roosevelt's summer home. But in 1915, of course, she is there supporting the workers at the massacre in Colorado, Ludlow. But She is, the Labor History Society helped get National Park Land, National Landmark status at her gravesite in Mount Olive, Illinois, which if you haven't been there, you should go. It's a union-owned cemetery, the miners own, and there aren't many miners left in this country. There's between 50 and 75,000 that are organized, I'd be surprised. Illinois was the second largest mining state in this country and, at the time, but Mother Jones has a reason to be revered as an individual, as somebody who believed in collective association and job action and a way to change society. And she never truly was called officially the most dangerous woman in America, but Elliot Gorn talks about that in his book on that, how that came about. Pardon me?
Wobbly stuff.
Mother Jones, Lucy Parsons, Big Bill Haywood, you could go on and on. Eugene Debs is in Chicago in 1905. I could talk on and on about Chicago. I sound like I work for the Chamber of Commerce when I do so. I'm always talking about Chicago, this Chicago, that. But really, I mean, that's why there's more local ones in Chicago than anywhere else. But the IWW really kind of brings the industrial workers of the world. You got to love them, right? Because they say, what, socialists and AFL people, you're going to organize 40 unions in a factory individually and nobody's talking to each other, why don't we just have one big union? And so, but what I love about it, Big Bill Haywood, by the way, you know, which is why I like good beer and good wine, Big Bill Haywood said, nothing is too good for the working class, right? So we should also have good food, good beer, and good wine, and where is mine? The IWW, there have been a lot, you know, some of our good friends from Kerr Publishing, Dave Rudiger, Penny Rosemont, and Frank Lewis Rosemont, I got to speak at his funeral a few years back, was buried in the Haymarket, and the work they've done to help us understand the archives and what the IWW was about, and the kind of, in a way, how the IWW was to sort of reinvigorated for many people what a labor movement could have been. They had crazy people too, just like we all do. Lots of culture wars within IWW, but it was the imagery that I loved. And one of the things that I like to do is that part of the problem, you know the movie, I didn't watch the whole thing, The Dark Knight, when what's his name, Heath Ledger walks in, you know, and he goes, why so serious? It was, you know, a very serious moment. But we take ourselves so seriously on the left and as progressives and union representatives. We don't celebrate. All we celebrate is being tortured. And I love music. I love art. I mean, why aren't we doing like the IWW, you know? Why aren't we, like, having a good time? Why, what Emma Goldman said, I don't want to be part of your revolution if I can't dance. To me, this is one of the big problems of the labor movement. And I can talk about the labor movement as an institution because I'm part of it. That's just a personal view. But I love the cartoons and the imagery, and it scared the very wealthy what they were about. And so it was in some ways some hope the new day, but again, you know, society's pretty difficult to organize workers, let me tell you, whether they have a law or not in this country. Elizabeth Gurley Flint. Who helped lead that Bread and Roses strike? By the way, I got a prize for somebody here. If they could tell us, not me, is it? Oh, I forgot the commercial. Turn off your cell phones. I got a prize for somebody. If they could tell us why it was called the Bread and Roses strike.
We want bread and roses.
Yeah, but you're not telling us why. And you don't. You're Charlie. You can't. You're like an administrator. You got to recuse yourself.
Oh.
No, that's International Women's Day.
Yeah.
Bread and roses. Okay, no prize. Oh, you got it. We got it. Keep an answer to that.
Maybe if memory serves me correctly, something to the effect that we're making the bread, we want to enjoy the roses.
I'm going to give you the prize. The idea is that bread is about, you know, the things that help us have a good life in terms of money and food and all that, but roses is about the love of life, and that you can only have that if you can have your means met. So you get one of our few. This will one day be worth lots of money. This postcard, the day will come when we dedicate it as a National Historic Landmark, the Haymarket. So if you'll you come up and get it after the program, so you get this beautiful postcard. We have a few of these left.
Good.
So, bread and roses. So that strikes. This is an example of why we need organization. Elizabeth Gurley Flynn, she's a 21-year-old woman. She likes this idea of the IWW and this change in culture and these old socialists who, you know, just sort of like narrow-minded and the AFL guys and all that. And she and others were organizing. She's a great speaker. She's buried right almost right next to Emma Goldman. She and Emma hated each other, by the way. She ended up in the Soviet Union, but then her body was brought back here. This is an example that it's not impossible to organize people who don't speak the same language. 26 languages were spoken in Lowell, Massachusetts in the mills. 26 languages. Every single meeting to organize that strike was translated 26 ways. And so, but the IWW played a great role in that, and Elizabeth Gurley Flynn, and it's another example of, and I talked about part of the Gazillion labor history event, anniversaries. It's 1912, so it's 100 years ago, not quite to the day that the strike was settled, where 55,000 women walked out of the mills, but basically gave a benefit to 350,000 people. And that's why when we have a movement that's organized, it doesn't take everybody to change things. It takes a threshold of people to change things. When one-third of this country was organized, we bargained for all of America, and we built an incredible society for about 75% of the country. We still have an underclass, but it was so different because of what happened in a very short period of time because people were organized and people had power. It's all about power. Who is powerful? That's what it is. It's about power. Now, you may not like the word. I don't mean it in the way of, you know, warring and domination. I just mean having a playing field that it's not tilted, or you're not running uphill and the other is running downhill when you're trying to get to the goal line. So the Bread and Roses strike, of course, is well acknowledged and celebrated, but isn't one of the only ones. But, you know, the period of World War I really changed a lot in our society. He ran away once I told him he couldn't have the
country. No, he's out indulging his bad habit right now.
Oh, okay. I'm going to move on. I don't want to talk about every single labor history event. I want to get to a couple of other things. By the way, the Stockyard Gate, the importance of Chicago again, and the strike of 1904 is what inspired our friend Upton Sinclair to write his book about the jungle. Which got not to the hearts and minds that he had hoped for, but to the stomachs of Americans that created so many reforms, and ultimately creates the United Packing House Workers of America in 1937, which is this year the 75th anniversary. But this period of, you know, I'm going to skip all this stuff about all the next Red Scare and the Pomerades, but I always like talking about baseball. I got in an argument on Facebook with somebody. You know who this is, right?
Judge Landis?
Judge Landis made Commissioner of Baseball for his anti-labor decisions, and I was reading an article about him. He talked about segregation. Do you know the owners were so afraid of this man that it was like the day after he died when Branch Rickey said, now we'll bring in Jackie Robinson. It took till 1947, 1920, what year was it when he became 1920, right after the Black Sox scandal, segregation of baseball because this guy was a segregationist and they didn't want to oppose the commissioner of baseball. So the Great Depression, you know, we all romanticize about it. It's sort of like, again, you know, but what's important about this period is the kind of thing that some of us have been talking about in terms of the New Deal, in terms of trying to make labor and society connect up again. Because one of the power of the New Deal was really the power of labor, the power of people in the community. Ultimately, you know, and of course, they didn't have benefits that people have today. So I think there was a stark difference, but at the same time, the realities are also very similar. And that the class war, the struggle, the stratification of wealth was so intense. Now it's actually greater in America. We are now 45th in the world. Actually, my understanding is that in terms of stratification of wealth, Rwanda is actually ahead of us by one country. It has less stratification than America. So, you know, you all know who that's on the right, right? John L. Lewis. So, another anniversary, right? 1937 again. He signs his contract with Big Steel, Carnegie Steel. He helps organize the CIO, the Congress of Industrial Organization, to create another one big union. It took 25 years, again, to get people thinking in those terms. But, hey, I don't know where to romanticize it. The CIO, they spend enough of their resources fighting people in the AFL just to get workers instead of organizing new workers, too. So those of you who are all about CIO great, AFL bad, it's not quite that simple, you know? John L. Lewis is an interesting guy. He actually supported Hoover. He didn't like Roosevelt. Who can explain that? But, this idea that I really like to present to people, young people, people who are activists in their union, is that they have not bought an insurance company to make changes for them. Larry Spivack and Rich Berg and Charlie Hogan, Charlie from the city of Evanston claims to be retired, but Charlie helped keep the privatization of the city of Evanston this year, and I'd love to, these guys were incredible winning that fight. Charlie retired, staying as a retired member, fighting the good fight.
Explain, it was a triad. It was the local, it was the union retirees, and it was those citizens in Evanston that really cared about.
And that is why I mention it in the context of the 30s, because it's a triangle. It takes a community, it takes a village. So, and we're not quite sorting that out. But, here's my favorite. I like this slide. The law gives us the right to organize. This is the one. If the president of the United States, the boss of the country, says, I would belong to a union, which this president wouldn't say. He'd say it to a certain group of people, but he wouldn't say it publicly. I could tell you, I could criticize Obama all day long. I'm going to vote for him, but I could criticize him all day long. I mean, these are our contradictions, right, that we try to do things at different, all on the same at the same time. There's many ways to approach problems. If this was the law of the land, which it is not, people aren't going to organize. If we can't get people organized, we're not going to get that threshold of the ability to raise the tie that will raise all votes. And so that's why you as citizens, even if you're not in a union or are afraid to organize a union, should be working with whatever coalitions are out there. That is my opinion. And finally, this whole period of sit-down strikes, this is the 75th anniversary of the Flint sit-down strike that just ended in January after 44 days. I'll get there in a moment. I always like this one, equal pay for equal work, and that's like the 1940s, right? Woolworth's workers went on strike. That just happened. The anniversary of that just took place. But look at this. Unionism is Americanism. Where are you? The U.S. government is 100% behind us. You know, how many workers that are unorganized somehow think that it's like anti-American to be in the union? The funny thing is, the only people that are unionized in this country are really the most paid, right? Tell me who's not in a union that isn't a lawyer, a doctor, a CEO, or a baseball player, or a super actor. If you're the wealthiest, you have 18 associations representing you. That's what a union is an association. It's a collective association of people who do lobbying and do interest work and work together. So how come the rich people all have a union and then average workers can't? Why is it that only 6.9% of the private sector has a union, but every rich person in this country, anybody making over $250,000 a year or $1 million a year, has the right to a union? You see what I'm saying? It is not about, we think upside down because we buy the rhetoric and we watch the movies and we watch the Fox News and the 24/7, and we've lost the culture war up to this point. And it's the only way we're going to get it back is by not just trying to pass a state rep, but by creating a culture that supports the idea of collective association. This is the Flint, Michigan sit-down strike of 1937. Again, we had our takeover of the factory at Republic Windows a couple of years ago, was one of the first ones in years since 1937. There were a lot of sit-downs, a lot of takeovers of plants back in the 30s. I'm gonna go on because I want to get to the point where I don't deny the democratic right of people to either say what they want to say ask questions. I want to spend time talking about the porters. I have a video, but I'm not going to do it. But here's a story that I love to tell. The story that even African-Americans don't even get to hear as much as we often revere Martin Luther King. How many of you know where he was and why he was where he was when he was assassinated?
I'm a man.
That's right. Gaffney, right? 1968. Most people don't realize he was supporting a workers' strike. And you know what? I'm going to give the words of what he says in his letter. There's just a short montage. I don't think it's on this one. But Sidney Hillman, a whole new idea of a union. We have been going downhill since 1957 because of the Taft-Hartley bill, but that's labor law stuff. The merger of the AFL-CIO and the role that some labor played in the civil rights movement. But you want to know what? I love Julian Bond because Julian Bond is telling the story about why music played such an important role in creating the civil rights movement. But ask me, in the UAW and a few other unions were big players in the March on Washington, in 1963, the Poor People's March, the March for Freedom, for Peace and Freedom, is because A. Philip Randolph, the Pullman Porter, the leader of the Porters, the 75th anniversary right now of their first contract, another 1937 anniversary, is the one that convinces Martin Luther King to have the March on Washington. He's the guy that told Roosevelt that if you don't desegregate the defense plants, that we're going to have a March on Washington, and then they passed the federal law. Order for desegregation of the defense plants in 1942. So, Cesar Chavez, you know, another story of farm workers that's a story that continues today. And our hero, right? The great actor, president of the Screen Actors Guild. Why is this important? It goes back to the question of why it's important what the boss of the country says. The boss of the country in 1935 said, if I worked in a factory, I would belong to a union. And 10 million workers joined a union in a few years and transformed our society. This guy, who was a union president, said, if you go on strike, and he did, I will fire you. And the next day, the right to strike in America ended when he fired the air traffic controllers. And since that day, wages in this country have declined every single year for the average worker. Now, I don't make this shit up. I can show you every graph that even right-wing economists have to show is the case. So, and I could do that if you want to stay here till midnight, because I got all kinds. Anyway, so it's also been a recent anniversary of the Piston, one of the last big coal strike. But and now we know what happens in non-union, especially in when the safety guidelines aren't respected. But this issue of globalization, we could talk about this for hours. But you know, the maquilas are now like they make too much money in the maquilas, so they got to ship it out to Honduras. But actually, Honduras they make too much money now, and in Guatemala they've been organizing and taking over the plants. So it's good to stay in China. You know, Walmart has 1,000 factories in China, and so here's the paradox, right? Walmart now has 52% of the grocery market in America. So what union can negotiate a contract with Dominick's or Safeway or Albertson if Walmart, totally non-union, controls 52% of the food market? Walmart has 1.3 million workers, and if you organize one Walmart, they will close it. If you know the story of the Texas amalgamated workers tried to organize, that they no longer sell fresh, you know, meat, but they don't have a deli where they cut meat. It's all packaged because they didn't want those guys to unionize that whole country. They closed down the Walmart in Quebec where they tried to organize. So Walmart, I say the paradox, because if you're a poor person, you're a working person, you are going to spend your money against your own interest because it's the cheapest place you could go because it's the cheapest stuff you could buy. I mean, how do you compete with that kind of volume? It's another example of the circular problem. I call it a paradox. I maybe don't know what a paradox is, but that's what I call it. And so yesterday's steel worker is today's correctional officer. If you live in a small community downstate, the best job you could have is to be a correctional officer because it's the only industry in a lot of these towns. And now the governor wants to close them down, but has no clue what to do in terms of, you know, since we imprison people instead of educate them, then you've got to have enough people to be in the place to keep it a safe place. Because what do we do in prisons is we teach people how to be criminals. So, but anyway, you know, we all know the nature of work has changed. We know that people are trying to organize, but they are stifled because our labor laws. You know, musicians, or almost all orchestras are unionized, by the way. I'm just showing the faces of workers. Every first responder of that event of 9-1-1 was a union member. Many of them asked me. And so these are the words of Woody Guthrie in the concert you're going to go to on May 19th, and the faces of some workers. Hey, that's me, my favorite subject. public steel. I don't always have that slide in there, but I couldn't pass it up. So, you know, I could, I'd love to share so many stories with you. I want to get your voices and hear what you have to say or debate or discuss. But this is what it takes to make change. Our union, we can be criticized. Our own success is actually killing us because workers were unable to build a long-term movement in this country. And so we got kicked off, public sector, private sector, now the public sector. We are putting up a fight, but, you know, I can't tell you how many people that call themselves liberals say, well, we got to end the pensions for public employees. So, you know, go figure. That's why we have to stand up every day and help people understand that it's their fight. It's not our fight. So I thank you so much for giving me this opportunity, and let's have a discussion. First come, first serve. All my buttons are free. You get the whatever buttons are left.
Who's got a button? Here.
Lights.
Thank you, Larry.
Thank you.
Yeah, they're coming. They're coming.
Enjoy that.
Okay.
All right. And now we come to our question period. And I see Pat Butler has a question.
Yes, sir. You made reference in the slideshow to Mother Jones leading a march on Teddy Roosevelt's summer home. Teddy was one of our more progressive presidents. What did he do at that time that got Mother Jones?
She was just trying to get legislation to stop child labor.
Oh, which he was in favor of anyway, was he not? I mean, in favor of stopping it. Was he not?
I don't know enough about Teddy Roosevelt, but the progressive era, right?
Yeah.
I don't know enough about you know, Obama is against or his four things work for, but we have to march on him too, right? I don't think Teddy Roosevelt was exactly like, you know, super progressive, but he had some good ideas that were better than some of the bad guys, so I don't know enough about Teddy, but that was what the march was about. Go to the back and then over here. I'm sorry, is somebody else moderating that?
Yes, I am.
Okay.
Okay.
Quick question, who was president at the time of the Monroe Massacre?
1915.
That would have been Wilson. Yeah.
Yes.
All right. Can you tell us anything about Foxconn and its labor practices in China?
No, I can't. I don't know about it. But I know a lot about labor practices in China, and I know about that the race to the bottom is that much of American and other corporations around the world have built these communities. And then, you know, and of course, Chinese entrepreneurs. Interesting thing about China is much, you know, so much of the country has grown, just like Central America, has migrated to cities where now there are millions and millions of beggars that they never had before because of the industrialization of China. At the same time, there's a burgeoning middle class. I mean, it's part of the evolutionary process of industrialization, I suppose. But I don't know. I've heard about Foxconn, but I can't speak with any degree of, maybe somebody else can and should. I'm sorry.
Tim, let's see. You've had your
question. I had my question. The next
yes,
one.
Yes. The doctor in back there.
Yep. Your text is our National Nurse United question for you, which we agree with you 100%.
100? Jojen's
book, The Labor Lawyer, he's agreeing with you, and one of the questions he's wondering
about... I'm having a little trouble hearing you because we're wrapping...
Jojen, the famous labor lawyer.
Yeah, I'm working with Tom on the Studs-Terkel thing right now.
So he agrees with you. How do we build a more diverse labor advocacy partnership? Because he feels we can't leave it to white men, and neither do I. So how do we build it? Do we do it through George Meany, or what can we do to move the force forward? Because I can tell you, I think National Nurses United has had a big thing. I think it's part of the reason WTO is not coming. So I think that we do have different leadership, but I think it takes time, and it can't be strictly white men anymore.
And it's not. The majority of our presidents are women in our union. Of course, you know what I love about my union is that if you go to a national convention or even a state convention, you see America. Uh-huh. I mean, that is one thing about public employment is you see America, you see the face of America.
Right.
And I love it because that's what but of course, diversity is important. And of course,
he's saying viability, not just important, he's saying viability. And I think that that's very important because I think we're going to have to hold the public sector unions up, which is, you know, if you're looking at healthcare, it's 85% women. So without us, we're not going to hold them. And I agree with you, we have to get to 30% nationally, but without the public sector unions, we're sunk. And that's why I think that we have to diversify broader.
A lot of people don't realize this, but of the 15 or 16 million workers that are organized, 50% of them are in the public sector now.
Right.
Yes.
So in order for us to get to 30%.
All you do is make that relationship to why Wisconsin, why Indiana, why Ohio. It's about the fact that public workers are the last, are the front line of the ability to stop the corporate agenda from totally destroying working people's lives.
Right.
That's the whole, I mean, what other conclusion can you draw?
They work for monopoly.
Right.
We have no choice. We have to pay. We're taxpayers.
Thank you.
We have to pay.
We
have a choice of where we can check. Yeah, I'm curious, the Illinois Labor History Society is just about 10 feet down the hall from the Henry George School.
Yes, yes.
Henry George solved all these problems, 150 years ago. Where the hell have you guys been? We know the solution to all these workers' problems. Tax on land. The only reason workers' wages are pushed so low is where have they been? I mean, we know that that it's the labor market that sets wages, not the goods market. And if people can employ themselves, they wouldn't have to go to work for bosses. Bosses would have to pay more.
You actually raise a really good, another what I call either a paradox or contradiction. The trades are a great example of this. Think about this. One of the most highly unionized sectors in society and skilled were the skilled trades. What would all these guys do? They're so skilled and so smart and raised the wages through didn't necessarily build a united labor movement, but, you know, built a lot of power to be able to negotiate great contracts and have a great life. And many of them became contractors and then sought to employ non-union workers if they could. But there was a time when everybody in the big city was a union worker. But the point is that they left the labor movement because their ability to start a business, because they knew the business and they knew how to do it. I'm just saying that it's an interesting contradiction because a lot of them ended up undercutting unions even though they were strong union members, you know. So.
Yes, Bill what?
Do scabs have a right to freely associate with bosses?
What?
I don't understand the question.
Scabs have
more
rights.
When you're talking about free association.
When I talk about free association, I talk about the right of workers to be able to talk to each other, to concerted activity, to gain power, the right to strike, the right to assemble on the street, in the workplace. So maybe you could clarify your question a little bit more for me.
Well, when you're talking about the right to strike, can you have a strike without a picket line keeping scabs out?
Yes. I'm sure there have been, I think there's examples of thousands of strikes where there weren't picket lines. There wasn't a picket line when they took over the factory in Flint, Michigan. They just took over the factory. Of course, the women in the community that were outside supported them, but you don't have to have a picket line. I mean, we should be creative. Maybe we should stop having picket lines. Maybe we should just take over every workplace. I mean, you know, but in terms of scabs, a good reason they're called scabs, because if I came up, do you have money in your pocket?
That's my business.
Do you have money in your pocket?
No, I
don't want to talk about my money. Okay. Do you have money in your pocket? Oh, you gave it to me.
I got money.
Who's got money in their pocket?
I do.
Okay. If I just walked up to you and put my hands in your pocket and took money out of it, you'd be a little bit unhappy, right?
You think you are going to explain to that guy with any reason?
No, I'm not trying to.
He have a religion,
no,
he said.
That's okay. I'm just trying to say, because a lot of this is really a way to have a discussion about why scabs are called scabs. Of course, we don't have strikes anymore because they're illegal, basically, in this country. It's a fundamental right under every basic religion, to the right to strike, right? Almost every industrialized, civilized society says you should have the right to strike. But for a basic reason, the worker should have some power. So when you have a scab, and this is what a lot of people don't understand because we weren't organized, even our own workers don't understand it, that if you take the work of somebody on strike, you are stealing their money. You are stealing food out of their mouth. It is nothing less than that, and should be understood that way, but it is a concept that seems kind of, you know, we like to all just get along. Yes?
Yes. Why are there steps?
Just a moment. You've had a question already. Frank Aguilar has some text.
Yeah. I am concerned about the labor around the world. We are not isolated anymore. So I see that the salt mines in Argentina are being exploited by children. They die by the age of 18, 20, because they don't use breathing and all that. And if they protest, they are put in jail as terrorists. No lawyers, no judgment. They are put in jail and that's it. Now, how are we able to improve the workers of the world to the point that it will be justice around the world and not fighting one fight here, the other there, and the other there?
Well, I got opinions, but nobody seems to know how to make it happen. But I think there's ideas, good ideas. I mean, one idea is that America, instead of being the leader of military industrial complex, should be a leader, because European countries would do this, at least most of them, would support much better labor standards around the world. If you could support labor standards that required minimum wages, that required certain safety conditions in other countries, and this was supported by most of the industrial nations, then it would change China pretty quickly. It would change Indonesia pretty quickly. It would change Honduras, El Salvador, and a number of the African countries pretty quickly, those who at least have some resources to be able to, you know, instead of, 1% of the country owning 98% of the wealth. But the U.S. has opposed that, just like they oppose most of those kinds of things, because we know who runs the U.S. And so I really think that there is a movement. I think there's been a change in the labor movement in the last 15 years that's pretty significant on the question of international labor. The steel workers are now part of the German Metal Workers Union. The number of unions are going international and recognizing this, and that unions are coming over here from other countries. It's kind of like why the Labor History Society tries to dedicate a plaque from an international association every single year, because this idea that we would raise the standard of living for poor people in other countries and as well as our own. Because if you can continue this race to the bottom that's going on through, and I think that's really what your question is about, we will just continue to see the stratification of wealth and the so-called, you know, for lack of a better term, underclass continue to grow, and people moving out of what, again, I use the term loosely, middle class, just to be able to have a phrase. But I think it's a question of fair trade. That's why it's been unfortunate. Another contradiction or paradox in the labor movement is that in the 90s and in the early 2000s, every time there's a free trade agreement, organized labor in the AFL-CIO says, this is terrible, you got to vote against it. If you vote for this, you will not get our support, but then they get our support. So it raises the question. I don't have the answer to this because I just said I'm going to vote for Obama, even though the guy is supporting things that I can't even stand. But he, and I'm not calling him the lesser of evils. I don't like that term. And just the point is, it's very complex. People make their own decisions about what they want to do. I think electoral politics is one way, but the policy decisions are driven by capital. Nobody can really explain the austerity question in Europe right now except the Central European Bank. And when I asked an economist about who runs the Central European Bank, he had no idea. Nobody else seems to understand
George
that
Soros.
So,
George Soros shorting the Europe, shorting the Greek currency
so,
is what it did.
It's such a complex question. We could debate this for hours. For me, the issue would be trying to get better. This would be the initial way, because I think it's doable, to continue to utilize the International Labor Organization to achieve better, to push the United States to support labor standards that are already supported by other countries but can't be implemented because the United States and a couple other countries oppose it. That would be a step in the right direction. And the other thing, as you know, that things that you can't predict happen very quickly sometimes. Governments are changed. We have seen governments in the last few years change just like that, and movements spring up. I think the question of global capital is the question for labor.
Mary Bennett?
Yes.
Oh, and I just want to tell the National Nurses Union representative that the Michigan delegation is getting a program from me on May 17th.
And they're going to have a virtual program in protest of the WTO going back to out east. So we'll see. And we agree with you. We think we're going to be in concert with 50 million nurses throughout the
world. If you...
We agree with you. We agree with you. We think we're going global.
Thank you. Let's see, Mary?
Yes. We know since 1964, after Johnson was reelected and all that, that the right wing and reactionary forces in this country have organized think tanks specifically for the purpose of influencing the terms of the debate. My question to you is, where is labor, doing to counteract, the misinformation that is out there to the general public, to the point that, quote, liberal, commentators, are parroting, the right-wing propaganda in this country.
Sure. And, it's always funny because those of us who consider ourselves, I used to love the organization, Fairness and Accuracy in Reporting, Jeff Bowe and others like that, because they were the few people that were able to point out that every single show on Nightline that was supposed to be a liberal, usually a corporate, another corporate suit, right? Another white corporate man in a court who, which was really taking a position that we would call right center. And so, Mary, again, there's a myth about labor. Labor, what we have, even though we're so much smaller, we still have 15 to 20 million people. We have people. And in terms of electoral politics, we are 12% of the workforce, but 26% of those who vote. This is because labor has learned how to communicate better with its members. And so labor union members are much more educated about society, except for wealthy people, than anybody else. Another reason that every single corporation is trying to destroy the right of labor to have members, because we can communicate to people better than anyone else, because we do have that kind of ability. Not all unions do it well. Some do it terribly. But it's about money. You are talking about, the AFSCME office. We have the one floor and the office building. But a small corporation has a 26-story building. So you are talking about hundreds of billions of dollars versus a few billion. You're talking about trillions of dollars and the ability to communicate, if you're just talking about labor, versus a few billion. The difference is that we understand, I say we, some of us understand that it's what Charlie said, which is that it's organizing the community, it's collective bargaining, it's the right to collective bargaining, and it's the right to legislate, to be able to have power over legislation.
Okay, we need questions. And Pat, you've already had a question, but go ahead.
Yeah, I'm a former unit chair of the Lerner unit for the Chicago Newspaper Guild, which is an AFL-CIO affiliate. Was, anyway. I don't know what its current status is. But
I think
what,
that's
CWA
now.
CWA.
CWA, yeah. Right. Communications Workers of America. What does it take to convince people that is it is in their interest to not only sign up, but be active in their unit? It was sometimes like talking to a brick wall.
They should invite me to tell the labor history program. But that's me. This is a struggle. This is a struggle for unions to listen. I'm a practitioner. I don't speak from an academic point of view. I've been a practitioner for 27 years. I've done collective bargaining. I've negotiated contracts. I do worker education. I do all kinds of those things. And workers are like everybody else. They're influenced by many things. I got a good friend who's an airline pilot. He loves his union, but he's staunch Republican and cannot make the connection. I'm not saying he should be a Democrat. I'm just saying that he votes against his own interest every single time, but he can't stand American Airlines. But he can't reconcile it because he was a fighter pilot and he somehow thinks that it's anti-patriotic. I mean, so these are difficult issues to convince people to not be against their own interest.
All right, the guy with the green shirt.
Okay, Larry, an observation that maybe you'd like to build out from it. I don't know why people can't figure out that most of the rich people can only wear the same number of shoes and suits that we all wear. The rest of their stuff is tied up in owning real estate or earning into clipping coupons. The rest of humanity, the other 99%, needs a check. That's what it's about. You don't have a rising middle class if you don't have people working.
Is that a question?
It's an observation. I'd like to ask him about where do you think we should be going as far as strategy, as far as building unions, because it seems to me that until they make that connection, once you've got that union card, along with the privilege of membership, comes the responsibility of participation. Because if the members don't participate, the leaders have no power. And being a leader, I speak from experience. When I had the men behind me, I never had to raise my voice.
Well, that's the magic of collective association in action. But remember that you're fighting against a propaganda machine that every day drills into you as an American that if you use collective association, you're weak, you're not a man, you don't deserve it, you're just a victim, and that the only way you can earn your way is by yourself. Reliance, right? And so you know where bootstraps came from, pull yourself by your bootstraps? The guy that owned, the president of Republic Steel that shot down the workers in 1937 wrote his biography, his autobiography, and he said, he called it bootstraps. That he hated unions because they were weak people who had to use other people to do their bidding, but he built his own corporation. Well, by God, George Pullman didn't do it by himself. He inherited his parents' money. And every single one of those people, there's a few rich people that are brilliant and do things, of course. But they write the laws, of course, to give them the advantage to do it. So, Charlie, going back to your question, how do we do that? It's about us constantly, I think it actually is through the struggle that takes place like in Wisconsin. Yeah. It's through the struggle, unfortunately, because we did as labor in the 60s, in the 50s and 60s especially, for so many reasons, a terrible job at educating our members. We lost 30 years. 30 years of the ability to organize, and so now we're just trying to catch up. But the good news is that even though organized labor, if you can use that term, I don't even know what that means exactly, and I'm part of it, I mean, let me tell you something. The nurses and AFSCME and SEIU and all of us, we spend half our resources fighting each other. Now, we all think we're right, so of course, we're going to fight each other. Well, what is it that we can't figure out that we're fighting each other like they did then and before? We do a better job of trying not to fight each other because of, so you're dealing with the, at the very essence of labor at the top to people whose egos are involved, are in the workplace. Like you said, somebody said, it took 30 years of propaganda machine of the conservatives to be able to, now where the debate is on the right wing instead of somewhere else. It's a long process, but I think that the real struggle that will change is it's not so bad that we have conflict. It's not so bad that it brings 100,000 people to the state capital of Wisconsin.
Eliana Weinberg?
Excuse my English again, okay? My question is, I would like to know your opinion in general. I have experience with the union. I'm talking in general. I was working for one big corporation almost 5 years. And make story brief, you have to be automatically, because it was part-time job, and you have to be automatically member of the union, right? So from first week, of course, they charge money for the union. But you know what? Not, it's not only my opinion. They, some people asking union, you know, for help, a little help. It was not major, but little help. They never, ever, I was working almost 5.5 years, they never ever help you people. Union, never. They hide.
Never.
They postpone. No, really, listen. They postpone meetings. They say they will come, like steward even or somebody representative. They never responded. So, you think it's honest? I mean, I'm from different country. Union in my country where I come from, not my country, my country, America. Thank you. country where I come from, you know, union, it's very cheap. Like it was almost like 14 cents a week you pay. But they really protected workers and they work together. And it's union in former Soviet Union, very strong. Here, like I'm asking you in general, how they can do, they charge money from workers who work in part-time, not even full-time, and they, in general, they really didn't help people. So how do you like that?
I don't like it. In fact, I can't argue with you. Your experience is your experience. And I could tell you, I could tell you out of 300 unions in my state council, I know a lot of locals that are bad because it's a democratic organization. This is the problem of democracy. People have to make a decision. Even if they have the resources, some unions at a national level are incredible in being able to provide education, some are terrible. But there, some locals are corrupt. Do you think I don't disagree with that? Some are incredible. Some are
some internationals are corrupt.
That's right. So we're people, like every institution. You know how you rob a bank? You own one. So it's, the point is that unions are institutions. And you happen to have experiences that weren't always positive. Maybe everyone was negative. That's unfortunate. But Charlie will tell you that that wasn't his experience. And most workers in their unions, and the polling shows it, like their union because they have a voice that no worker else has. And so it's not perfect. It's imperfect. It's a flawed world. We get people who are presidents that we vote for because we're mad at the other person because they didn't allow... they didn't talk to me on the lunch at lunch. I mean, you know, it's the way it is. And so we have to be, I'm saying, we always strive, at least the union that I work with in Illinois, to do constant education, constant member involvement, constant citizen action, and a small percentage of people will do that. How many of the people you know have perfect families?
All right. So, Charlie Pinnock?
Yeah, Larry, I was looking at all your slides. You must have 35 or 50.
No, there were 160.
There were people throwing bombs, wrecking factories, rioting in the streets. Now, I have a job. I go to work. I'm just glad I have a job. I don't
You know, I'm not there to tell the boss off or anything. Just do what the boss tells you to do, right? And it'll be a lot better, right?
That's right. Question.
But anyway, he only makes a pass at your wife.
I get your point.
But seriously, aren't there, isn't there labor laws in the United States?
No, there aren't.
No.
They're not enforced. Actually, SOLAS is a pretty good Department of Labor. You know, the whole idea of the Department of Labor, Francis Perkins, by the way, you know, in the Department of Labor under Roosevelt, first woman appointed. The Department of Labor is supposed to actually represent workers, but mostly over the last 50 years it hasn't. These are questions for people. So to decide, we decide everything is driven by profit, or we decide whether there should be a public sector, whether there should be, public sector should only be for the military and every school should be private. We make these decisions, and so we make the decisions in the workplace. The problem is that there have to be some good leaders, because good leadership, and this is where I get into fights with some people who always talk about democracy. This is where I think that critics of organized labor really make a mistake. They love to write about, I'm talking about left-wing critics, by the way, who love to write about this anti-democracy. But all the people that I know in the labor movement, not all, but most of the ones that I know that consider themselves leftists, they can't organize their own members. They'd much rather just talk about how big labor isn't doing anything and they have the worst organized place, because that's what they do. And so it's about doing the work. It's about getting your hands dirty and stuffing envelopes. Okay. That's what it's about.
Okay, Tony Ball.
Larry, why was Occupy Wall Street able to co-opt the issue of class consciousness? Why didn't that come from the unions? I was in a union for over 40 years. They did a horrible job of educating the members, and they said nothing about class, something that we've got to mention.
Well, I would probably say that the 1917 was a defining year in this world. And so in 1946, when the best activists were purged from the AFL and the CIO, you lost the best people. Yeah. And I would say that the Cold War and the anti-communism and the social contract in some ways really destroyed the ability of us 50, 60, I can't even do the math anymore, to be able to do that education and organizing. And George Meany said in 1963 or something, when they had 16 million members, we don't need any more members, we have enough. And so, that's a problem. It's a problem when the AFL-CIO was working with the CIA to overthrow the government of Allende, and you go on and on and on. I mean, a lot of that has changed. A lot of thinking and a lot of people have changed, but that's a legacy that is hard to overcome. Now, your union maybe didn't do it as well, but other unions did it very well. But the issue of class is like using in church the word fuck, right? You know, in America. So, I'm sorry, I'm just trying to think of a metaphor. I don't know, maybe it's a bad one. But so Occupy is, in terms of that issue of class, remember the Cold War is sort of over too in some respects, and so now young people could care less. A lot of young people, they call Obama a socialist. What the hell is that? Who cares if he's a socialist? You know, the rhetoric has changed. And we're a couple generations now removed, and there's opportunity that wasn't available because of the Cold War. I think the Cold War was a huge problem for labor in many respects.
All right. It's now 10 o'clock.
They're going to kick us out?
Out of here at 11 o'clock because they are tired and they want to go home.
Can we do a sit-down strike?
That I would like to know how many people here have something to impart to the rest of us who would like to speak to things.
Talk yeah,
to
thank you.
How many?
Good.
How many have something? One, two, three, four, five, six, seven, Hey, well, you get...
You get the last word.
I love it. Last word.
Last word.
Three, four, six, seven, eight.
25 minutes.
Well, about 3 to 4 minutes.
Short statements.
5 or 6 minutes.
No, no.
5 minutes. 5 minutes.
Who am I here for?
Each.
Maybe.
But Peter Perro has the last question.
Quickly for Larry.
Larry.
Larry's engaged.
I'm sorry.
Last question.
In 10 years from now, will there be a? In 10 years from now, will there be a post office as we still know it? And can labor do anything to roll back those jobs?
So I want to tell you a scary story. I was in Arizona. First of all, this is how I think. A short story?
Yes.
Okay. I like this guy because he knows how to keep things moving. And that's what we should do. But this illustrates how complex this is. I talk to people every single day, not because of my job, but because of my passion, what I believe about workers. And the other day, when I went to the post office, the iron workers were standing there with their things on because they were protesting the non-union labor at the Volvo dealer. And I said, "Where are you guys out?" And they told me it was non-union. So I said, "I'm going in there and I'm going to talk to the manager and tell him I'm a citizen here and he's got to stop using non-union labor." And I did it. Now, how many people do that every single day of their life? That's what each of our responsibility is, to take responsibility. Just like the right wing talks about responsibility, well, take some damn responsibility and do something every day that you believe in if it's about the cause of labor. Regarding the post office, the postal guy, I talk to these people all the time. I say, "Hey, you know, I work for a union. I'm working with you guys to help stop the closure of half the post offices and lay off 150,000 postal workers." And you know what he says to me? "This is a worker. This is a worker." He says, "Well, you know, the problem is it's the internet, and besides, it's not even our responsibility to deliver junk mail." But then, you know what he said to me? After, what he was trying to say is, "Oh," and then he sort of said, "Hey, it's going to happen. What are you going to do? You know, that's the way it is." Then he said, "But I just hope they don't do it until after I retire."
Right.
So this is a typical person. I mean, this is how people think. These are our members. If you're in a union, you know your members.
I got mine.
He's got his. So we got to educate our members every single day. We got to talk to our neighbors. We got to know how to talk to our neighbors. We got to understand our history. We got to know that there's a legacy. We got to know that people win things because of collective action. That's what changes it when a few people control everything. That's how every single society changes. And so that's abstract, that's rhetoric, that's dogma, but you can do it every single day. That's what I believe.
Good answer. All right.
Let's see, I didn't explain, and some of you are new to us, but we have these chairs up here, and the person on my right, your left, on the end here, speaks first, and we all play musical chairs and move along after they've spoken.
One at a time. Is that hard to say?
All right, one at a time. Anyway, without any further ado, you can sit down now, Larry, and enjoy. But take careful notes.
All right, you get 5 minutes each or so, right?
Yeah, 5
right.
minutes.
All right, let's take a speaker.
That's all right.
Hey.
We should also give a hand to Paul for helping on the technical aspects tonight, too.
Tim Bolger, who is recording by
us. Well, I'm here every week.
By the way, anybody who doesn't want to be photographed,
too late.
Tell that man before he doesn't.
Let's get these rebuttals going, gentlemen.
Is this stuff going to the Red Squad right tonight?
Joe Mayer, first.
You remember that?
I am a retired member of AFSCME, and I derive a lot of benefits from it, and I do a lot of work for it. But I also belong to another union that our speaker didn't really emphasize. I was a member of the United Legal Workers, a union of lawyers. most of whom, of course, work in the poverty law area.
Yeah.
I worked for the Legal Assistance Foundation of Chicago at the time. My mentor was a fellow by the name of Albert Weisbord. He was born in 1900. He finished summa cum laude from the Harvard Law School and then immediately went to Massachusetts and became a weaver. He didn't practice law. He passed the bar in Massachusetts and New York, but he became a weaver in Massachusetts. And when he read about the story of the strikers in Passaic, New Jersey in 1925, he immediately went to Passaic, New Jersey, and because he spoke several languages, he was able to organize the workers in five of the mills, textile mills, in Passaic, New Jersey. He did so because the employers had selectively placed people who didn't speak the same language in various departments. So he was able then to, with his skills and languages, able to organize them all. He took the entire five mills out on strike for 1 year. For 1 year they were on strike. Now, the mill owners, of course, employed the police and the National Guard. Because Passaic is pretty close to New York, it became a matter of publicity. The New York Times and other organizations would come to Passaic, the reporters with their cameras and so forth, and the police and the National Guard would beat the reporters as well as the strikers.
Yeah,
and they would destroy their cameras. So the very clever New York reporters decided they would hire phony reporters with fake cameras. And they would go out and take pictures while the reporters and the photographers were on the rooftops taking pictures of the police beating the fake photographers. Pathé World News. Some of you, I'm sure, remember who Pathé World News was. It was a in all of the movie theaters around the country, before the double feature, there would always be the Pathé World News. The Passaic strike was a figure in every Pathé World News throughout the United States, where they showed pictures of the police and the National Guard beating the strikers and beating the fake reporters and so forth. And that was a method for organizing. They made appeals for money to help the strikers live through the strike. And they collected a lot of money and distributed to the striking families. The strike went on for, as I say, almost a little over a year. And then the AFL was called in by the Communist Party, as a matter of fact, to help resolve this situation. My mentor, Albert Weisbord, was then a member of the Communist Party, and he was selected to go to a conference in Moscow, which removed him from the activity, the active participation in the Union. And he was over there for about 6 weeks or so at the conference. And when he came back, he was excluded. He could not participate in the strike anymore, because the AFL had struck a deal with the mill owners, and that was it. The strike was over, and the workers were no better off than they were before the strike began. Weisbord, of course, resigned from the Communist Party immediately. But the reason I'm telling this story is because there is an example of activity, how you can do it. If you graduate summa cum laude from Harvard Law School, you become a corporate lawyer, but he didn't. He became a weaver and worked in that field for many, many years. Thank you.
Thank you.
Yeah, I am the one that called plastic ship Frank. We are entering into a very difficult period in humanity because we are running out of fuel. We are changing the weather We are changing the weather in the whole world. We are warming up the earth. And the majority of people don't understand the scientific processes or the physical processes that they could really be understood under a scientific scrutiny. So we have a lot of work to do to educate people as to the complexities of not only the lack of fuel coming up and the change in weather patterns, the exploitation of the seas to the point that in a few years we will have a total collapse of the fish population in the seas. Then we have loss of topsoil by the way that we cultivate the topsoil. We have to confront many, 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 many different issues. And I think that the union should be a place of education because the wealthy send their kids to very good schools and they have connections and they keep the ball rolling. But we are not educated to confront the realities and to fight these idiots that we have up there, the paid prostitutes we have governing us, then we are in a losing proposition. I mentioned about the salt miners in Argentina. These kids are born in there and they start packing salt into bags that they are given by the company. They get about 50 cents or so a day, and this each 25 pounds of this special salt is sold in the market for about $100. And so they pack several bags of this a day, each person, each kid, and they get nothing. They are totally isolated from the rest of the world. They don't have education, they don't have running water, they don't have health. It's just a mess. But if they protest, when they say they are taking our land, they kick them further and further away from their lands, just searching for that soul. And so they put them in jail as terrorists. And because now the United States have convinced everybody that anybody who protests is a terrorist. And they are judged with the same measure that we do here. If you are a terrorist, you don't have no rights. You put away, and that's it. If you're black on it, that's it. So anyway, that we are polluting the seas with plastic to a degree that is hard to imagine. The reason that this is important is because the plastic release and the ultraviolet radiation, they release hormones that affect the developing of the fish's fetus, eggs, and so on. So we are creating. Another thing that I've been fighting for a long time, I've been involved in different organizations, and one of the things that I really asked many years ago, it was to have certain kind of our consciousness about the world that we live in, and the consciousness doesn't stop in our little house with our immediate relatives, but it involves our consciousness when we are in a group like this. And if we are not respectful of each other, and I explained this before, then how we expect to be respected by people that are in power or anything like that? So I don't know if I made myself understood, but I think we should look at each other and say we are friends and we should respect each other.
I'm Michael Foley. I haven't got much to say tonight, but I am glad that I came here and I am glad that I heard the presentation. I'm in favor of labor unions. And when I say labor union, I mean any kind of blue collar, pink collar, white collar, professional, whatever, educated, uneducated, whatever. I think that the only hope workers have for any kind of civil treatment is to be united, to be together, to be in a union. I used to work construction for a lot of years, and there was always guys bitching about the union. Oh, they just take our money, they don't do nothing. And I told them, I always said, if it wasn't for the union, the wages would be half of what we're getting. We'd still have to do the same amount of work, but the wages would be half and there'd be no benefits.
Yeah.
No hospitalization, no nothing. But that's about all I got to say, but I am in favor of labor unions. And labor unions and workers, whether you're union or not, we're all under attack. Thank you.
Yeah. You hear that? Half the pay. One half.
First, I want to thank the speaker, thank the preceding gentlemen before me. I had some little thoughts about coming over, and then I saw a history of labor, and I'm thinking, like, well, history is always interesting because it gives you something to extrapolate from, compare, and when you're my age, it might be part of you. Thank you for a speech, and you did a good job. Your cadence was on time. We usually have people interrupt the speaker. You kept them where they're supposed to be, listening. And if you listen, you might learn something. Now, if you can look at me, I'm part of history. And I don't see nobody with their grandkids, great-grandkids in here, so a lot of y'all should be part of history. I was a grown man when Walter Ruther died, when Cesar Chavez died, or when Lewis, the United Co-Workers Day. I heard about them, and they was of some interest to me. There were things mentioned in the movie, for instance, in the thing about the child labor, and so forth and so on. That brings back certain memories. Because when I was a kid, 6 or 7 years old, and you went to the cotton field, you didn't go out to play, you went out to work. And the grown folks had a sack like 9 feet, and the women would be about like 6 feet, and the kids, like my age, 7, they would take a cotton sack, a flour sack. The people in the country would get flour at the store in cloth sacks, and it served two purposes. Women made dresses and blouses out of them, because they had flower patterns on them. And a little kid like me, they put a string in there, and that's my cotton sack, by the way. Now, that was honored, I guess, and rightfully sold by a lot of people way back then, and even now, because even here, kids are still working, but in certain countries like South America and somewhere else, kids are working and we complain about it. Now, I remember out there working, and I can look back, and I don't think it did me too much harm. I think it did me a lot of good. Working ain't never bothered me, because that's what I did all my life. And I don't remember nobody whooping my ass making me work. Well, if you was goofing around, you might not ask whooping. But anyway, I did that. More interest is what you can get from what he taught us tonight, what he showed us. And like he said, obviously, it would take weeks to give the full picture of history of labor. And he wasn't up here to give us weeks of history of labor. But he did an adequate job, more than adequate job, for me with his history. And like I said, George Adams said, if you don't know history, you're going to make this sick and so forth, and you don't glorify. I say history is a little more than that, especially when you're part of history. History reminds you that yesterday can be your tomorrow or your next week. It was so-and-so last week, but it might be your ass next week. That's what history tells us, that it's nothing under the sun is new, and everything is not black. The propaganda would have us believe everything is not like the guy that look you in the eye and tell you 2 and 2 is 5. History is what it is. History makes itself. And I'm part of it. I can make a certain, draw a certain conclusion from my experience that I'm confident in. the conclusion that I draw, because I was here when these things was happening and so forth and so on. If other people my age done lost track of that, I don't understand why. Because if you don't know what happened yesterday, how are you going to be prepared to know what's consistent with what happened yesterday and so forth and so on? And you have to keep that in mind, because if you don't keep it in mind, you will end up thinking that the world, like young folks, when I say young folks, I'm talking about 15-year-old. The world began with him. But forget about what happened before. Is my time up? Oh,
have to introduce yourself. I've forgotten your name already.
My name is Kirk Johnson.
Kirk Johnson. Okay.
I'm new here, and I obviously there's been a very pro-union voice today, and I don't disrespect it. And I acknowledge that unions have done a lot for a lot of people, and that there's a real tragedy going on in this country right now that's related to the destruction of unions and the loss of wages and the loss of benefits. And it's, you know, this train is wrecking. It's not, it's wrecking. And there's, but I want to tell add a perspective to this. And I, when you said you were talking about scabs, you know, how was the scab made? And the scab was made by saying, United we stand, let's build our house, and we're in here, and you're out there. And you are a scab if you try to take our work or our jobs. But the union was supposed to be the thing that united everyone. And it did. It united itself, and it expanded it. Yeah, out of that strength, it created a lower class. And when I came out of school, when I was 16 and 17, and I needed a job, there were no jobs in my neighborhoods, actually. But the people who were getting jobs were people who got legacy union jobs. Their families were in the unions and the rest of them. I worked for 2 years in a company where I worked for one quarter of people who worked alongside me because they were in union and I was not. And I had, that was my lot. I did that work exactly as hard as they did, but I got one quarter of the wages. Now, I'm from the, I'm a 60s baby. And we know the Ludlow Massacre, we know these things. And my generation were the hippies. And I don't know, I call them Nixon's goons, but they were the union guys who beat the shit out of the hippies at when the anti-war demonstrations were going on. And you know, so here's this class divide, so along comes Ronald Reagan and fires off a complete union. And nobody gives a shit. There's a reason for that. I wasn't worrying about that. It wasn't my bone to pick. But I was already outside of that union. And I'm not objecting about for unions. I'm not saying they're not valuable, but there's a reason why the unions collapsed. And it was, they did this exact same thing that the owners did. They took that power and they used it to exercise, to amplify their own power, rather than to keep the community and continue to build the community. And that's what happened. And that's what happens. And when people go to Walmart and buy their goods, they're not hurting themselves. They're doing the best they can with what they got, given the circumstances they've got. And they don't care about your union because they don't belong to your union. And so how would you solve that? That's a big question. And that's a question that needs to be answered. But that's my comment, so thank you very much.
Well, I could go on for hours too, I guess, on this subject. And I think you have a fair belief on that. If you don't believe anything else I'm saying, I think you'd believe that. But anyway, this doesn't, I don't know if this exactly qualifies as labor history, but the Newberry Library had a session several years ago. I think it was the centennial of the Wobblies. It was at the Newberry Library. And I got up there and I said that maybe unions ought to have a different attitude towards scabs. I thought I'd get all kinds of
raspberries for that, but surprised that there wasn't any real hostility. But here we get a union head several months ago, he said, we got to talk about happiness. And he said, happiness is a warm baseball bat. Well, what is a scab? A scab is a worker who cannot find a job good enough for a striking unionist. And you talk about hiring non-union, you don't want to go on hiring non-union labor. Well, where is non-union labor supposed to work? If it is supposed to work, it should just go out there and starve to death.
A scab puts his interests above those of everyone else.
Well, how about union heads? You don't put your interests over everyone else. Again, you know, this is something we can talk about for hours.
I'm more important than everyone else in this room.
Yeah, you are.
Yeah.
At least you think you are.
Yeah.
Take that, Bill.
But anyway.
You lost.
I could give a several hour talk about just about the contradictions in this union paper here. It's not just that. Well, I think actually there's something in here that actually has some pretty good advice for you union heads. It goes into a union head on the picket line who mooned some non-union workers and used some pretty vile language and so on. They say the union's got to keep up standards. I kind of wish some of you guys would try to keep up some standards too.
We'll try.
I hope so.
Please. Standards be scabs, yeah.
All right. Just so I don't want to give into a cat and dog, but just so. You know, I've been saying for years there's a capitalist union, and I think this is something that a government employee union ought to. I think there's some credit. Well, the others say that the capitalists, they're dealing with people that they put in office too. It's not just unions that are doing it. And there's such a thing as a capitalist union, and the reason that a capitalist union is so effective is because your union heads are helping enforce it.
I'm going to give a little bit of a speech tonight that's probably going to give you guys a little bit of a little bit of a pit in your stomach. Because I'm one person who likes unions. I like what they've done. And I like the standard of living that they have created in this country by, you know, those employers who will take advantage of workers. But I will say one thing. You won't have a job without a company. You won't have work without a capitalist system to underpin your jobs. You would not have a job in a factory or in a small business without a capitalist system. And for me, you know, it makes a lot of sense. I'm trying to get more, as Frank says, evidence-based on what has happened. And I take a look at the track record over 300 years, and you know how much the world has changed over the last 300 years because of this capitalist system. Now, granted, it has problems. It has corruption, it has things else, but I have thought of no other way to create wealth, power, and whatever than without the benefits of the free market. And if you really get down to think about it, what does this green represent? We trust our federal government that this will be honored for all debts public and private. And trust is the key that makes a system work. Now, we have seen a lot of the rise of the internet in the last few years. But do you realize the amount of cooperation that has to be done, for example, with the simple structure of HTTP or Hypertext Transfer Protocol? Or if you look at something called the RFCs that underpin this standards that will go in. And there are a number of companies that come in because of these standards that are represented and met. And in a lot of cases too, you know, international trade, capital, is all under some kind of standards. And right now, what's happened in Wall Street over the last few years has been a relaxing of those standards, particularly in the unregulated derivatives trade market. It is much more profitable today for a bank to invest overseas and to put more debt on us as American workers and to keep our wages low. Wall Street today, and most of the profit centers to your large banks are done, is in the derivatives market. And that, my friends, is really what's brought down the American institution. The Great Depression was caused by margin and an over-reliance on credit. And it's almost the same thing happening today, but it's called the derivatives market. And a lot of the commercial paper interests that go through it. We used to have something called Federal Deposit Insurance and a separation of the investment banks against commercial banks. And with those standards breaking down, that's one of the reasons that we're seeing this economic collapse. Now, for years, the bankers have gotten away with a lot of stuff. And this is why, you know, monopoly practices, too big to fail. Didn't we go all through all this stuff with, I want to say Roosevelt, but Teddy Roosevelt, the trusts of the 1820s? There was a real, in the early 20s, there was a real hostility between labor and management. And it wasn't until labor and management made peace and cooperated with each other that things finally started turning around. Labor would get on our contracts. Now, I understand that there's a lot of problems today with corporations wanting to get bigger and bigger and bigger, and they want to exploit their workers more and more and more. So in a lot of cases, organization is desperately needed, particularly in a place like Walmart or some of our medical facilities, or even amongst government workers, that the people who are on the lower wage tiers. There is no question that unions are needed. But at the same time, you know, what's also really needed, in a sense, is more capitalism, more access to credit, more opportunities for people to build small businesses and thrive.
More child labor.
And Charlie, you know, as countries develop, child labor goes away. As countries develop, if you look at China right now, their labor laws are starting to get enforced, and a lot of companies there are moving out to other countries where they can exploit labor. And guess what's going to happen there? The rest, my friends, I think the world is looking bright. We're in a more peaceful world today than we've seen around the world. More people are rising out of poverty. These developing nations are, those developing markets are now called emerging markets.
No, they're not.
And I'm saying that, you know, there's still a lot of change going to go on. There's still a lot of problems we have to address, but I think where we can really start, even, and keep, please, unions, keep up your efforts, because there is always going to be somebody out to exploit workers. There is always going to be somebody out to take an advantage of it, especially with some big guy who thinks he has everything and needs more. But at the same time, remember that it's those very companies, too, that provide your jobs. It's those very big companies, too, that go through things.
I seem to forget that.
And the other thing that you got to realize is, remember the financial aspects of it. They need to be regulated to a certain degree to make sure that the capital does its job and invests in companies and not to be invested in default credit swaps and derivatives. If capital could be, if this monopolistic power of Wall Street could basically be opened up to capitalist forces, I think half our problems would be solved. So it's not that capitalism is bad.
Yeah,
It's that Wall Street is a monopoly, and we need more capitalism in Wall Street.
You got one friend.
Charlie.
Well, first off, like I say, Tim, the Chamber of Commerce is going to revoke your membership, calling for unionization of Walmart stuff. Of course, that's not what we need. We don't need less freedom. What is a union but nothing but a cartel? It's protectionism. Protectionism, socialism, and communism are three branches of the same weed, folks. It's all about privilege. It's all about, you know, getting higher than market wages. You know, for you, unions never raise the general wage for all working people, only for their members.
We have to go to the
root of the problem for all workers to make things better for all workers. And how do we do that? Well, there's three factors of production, folks, and labor and capital are only two of them. Everybody always leaves out the most important factor, land. Now, the reason why wages are so or low, the reason, like in that little video that he played, you see this, you know, the trouble that these day laborers have competing for work against each other. Well, that's because there's not enough work for them because there's not opportunity in land. Now, back in colonial days, we had no unemployment. If you had openings, you needed to hire people. Man, you were in deep doo doo. If you didn't have kids of your own to work for you, you know, it was hard to get people. You had to pay a pretty penny for them. And if you worked for somebody, you were kind of looked on suspiciously as perhaps maybe being not very ambitious. Because why would you work for somebody else when you could work for yourself? And indeed, because of the fact that there was opportunity in land, people could employ themselves as farmers, as cabinet makers, as blacksmiths, and all kinds of other, trades and things. But now we can't do that. And why? Because of the fact that we've allowed monopoly in land. So a handful of people have bought up all the land, and they're holding it off the market for a higher price. And that's forcing what land is available, forces up the rents higher. Whether if you're going to rent, you have to pay rent, or if you're going to buy it, you have to pay a higher sales price, because there's sales price of land is only, that's just the future, the present value of the future cash flows of the anticipated rents. So that's why we have situations like downtown Chicago. Some of the best real estate in the world, and a lot of it is sitting there vacant. And there's labor that wants to work, and there's capital that wants to employ them, but labor and capital can't come together. Labor and capital are not antagonists. We're partners. But we can't come together because of the landlord wanting too much rent. So you look at places like down right in corner of Van Buren and Michigan. There's two storefronts right next door to each other, both empty. Isn't that terrible? Van Buren and Michigan in Chicago. And you got people sleeping in the doorway there that would like to work. They can't because the rent's too high. And labor and capital can't come together. Remember, labor and capital only keep what's left after the rent's been paid. Now, if we had your union head utopia like you all wanted, what would happen if everybody made all this money? Well, we know from reading Adam Smith, the conclusion of chapter one, all benefits of a society accrue to the landowners. So all that would happen, folks, is rent would go up, and you would be no better off. For instance, I used this example before, if I said I'm going to give $400 a month to every person that lives on the west side of Ashland Avenue, free $400 a month food credit at Jewel to everybody that lives on the west side of Ashland, what would happen to all the rents on the west side of Ashland? They would all go up. How much would they go up? $400. Who benefits? Landlords. I wonder if instead of a $400 a month food credit, I wonder if I said, this is a popular union rhetoric our gentleman friend likes to use all the time, I wonder if I said, we're going to have a living wage in Chicago, and instead of the border being Ashland, the border is going to be Chicago. We're going to have a living wage, everybody's going to make $1,000 a week minimum wage. Now what's going to happen to rents in Chicago, folks? They're going to go up. And they're going to go up by some amount. The landlords are going to figure this out of what the
you know, this kind of aggregate amount of increased wealth is, and they're going to, because land is a monopoly item, and that means it's not, you know, it's priced to what the market's going to bear. These guys can raise the prices as high as they want. They don't really have to compete because there's only a fixed amount of land. So anyway, the solution to all these problems, folks, is real simple. We need to start raising taxes on land, not buildings, raising taxes on land, lowering income and sales taxes, and that will put land on back on the market. Labor and capital will be able to come together. Labor will be absorbed, and wages will go up. You can learn more about this at the Henry George School, just 10 feet down the hall from the Illinois Labor History Society.
Oh, I missed it.
Still there. Maybe
we should go on together.
We should.
We can teach you guys something.
You know, I used to subscribe to a little
into the microphone
out, called Union Democracy in Action. And it was about struggles within unions to make them democratic. Well, they very often were not. There were democratic, more democratic unions, but like all capitalist organizations, unions in the United States were pretty bureaucratic, and people like to be secure in their jobs as union bureaucrats, and they don't encourage people to argue on questions that might be divisive and rock their boats. So lots of unions do not have very well attended meetings because they're run by the leadership, and the leadership don't want questions raised that might disturb the unity and peace of the organization. Unions can be, union members can be organization men just as well as the various bureaucrats in any corporation. At any rate, making unions more militant, more democratic, more class conscious is the aim of a good many people on the left, socialists, progressives, anarcho-socialists, whatever. And I remember the Reverend A.J. Musson. A.J. was a Presbyterian minister who lost his pulpit in Boston in World War I because he was a pacifist and he was opposed to making war, and he wouldn't bless war, and he wouldn't go along with what was considered patriotic Christianity. So he lost his pulpit, but he maintained a fellowship in Boston that was supportive of a lot of Christian causes, and he became the relief agent for the textile workers in Lynn, Massachusetts, who were on strike during the war and right after the war. Other union leaders were arrested and thrown in detention centers, and the workers turned to him because he could speak to people, he understood people, and he could be their liaison to the press. I think they're going to turn off the
sign. You don't have much time, bro.
At any rate, this has a fresh battery, so. Yeah.
At any rate, he became the president of the spokesman for the union, and he also, after that, he was the president of the Brooklyn Labor Institute, and he became the leader of a Trotskyist sect, the Musteites. Then I knew him from the Fellowship of Reconciliation and the Congress of Racial Equality, and he had a Presbyterian church in Manhattan, Labor Temple. But he wasn't an exception. He was one like Martin Luther King, who was mentioned before, with Memphis sanitation workers. King had done his thesis on Gandhi.
Time's up.
Yeah, you're right.
Thank you. Good background.
Ironically, I found myself agreeing with several people that I don't normally agree with. But the fact of the matter is, yes, we do, whether we like it or not, for the moment, we do need capitalism. We also need unions. We also need government. It's a tripod that holds society together and keeps things going for the moment until we, in this room or elsewhere, have come up with a better system. Now, it is true that unions are on the ropes. It is true that the labor movement in this country has become almost terminally flaccid. And you know where the blame lies? It isn't with the corrupt union bosses. It isn't with the bureaucrats who don't want to be bothered with questions from the rank and file. It's from people in the unions themselves who decide they're going to leave it to the shop steward. They're going to leave it to the union chair. They're not going to bother to go to meetings. As long as they keep getting those raises and getting those comfortable benefits, it's not their problem. Well, now we live in an age where it quickly becomes their problem. And one of the reasons union membership has dropped off has been because of the fact that management has been able to tell union after union in many places, and I've seen it here in Chicago, well, you don't need the unions anymore. You're part of the middle class. We're not going to take away the benefits that you've already got, and we're certainly not going to cut back your salary. Now, if you believe that, folks, I have a wonderful bridge over at Michigan Avenue, right by the river, that I will be happy to rent to you. You can charge tolls and make that money back. If you believe that kind of a story.
I thought it's called privatization.
I saw it time and time again at Learner Newspapers and at Pioneer, where they made an attempt to decertify the union. And they did. They did by going around telling people, you don't need the union. In fact, we're going to give you a 25% raise, and we're going to give you a 15% raise. And do you know who the guy, the only guy that's going to benefit if the union stays around? They point toward my desk, Butler. Because, you know, and so they divided everybody. And it was a very, very unpleasant situation. So unpleasant, as a matter of fact, that years later, there are people that still don't talk to one another. So the fact of the matter is, it calls for rank and file involvement, because every day, in every way, what happens does affect you. And if we want to see the labor movement in this country get a shot in the arm once again, we have to think in terms of greater involvement day to day, recruiting, active recruiting, information, not to the point where it becomes totally nebulous and doctrinaire, but practical information, how to get grievances done, what the union can do for you, what the union can't do for you, what you have to do for yourself. It's education, but it's a day-by-day sort of thing, and the union is going to revive itself, the movement is going to revive itself, person by person over a period of time. Yes, it's on life support right now. But being on life support doesn't mean you're dead. You know, until they come in and actually give you the last rites, you're still around. So, you know, don't bury the union movement too quickly. And, you know, don't regard it as an anachronism. And, yes, there's plenty of need for unions. And you'll notice that I completely avoided the issue of scabs because we do not have three more hours to discuss that here tonight. They're about to throw us out. Thank you very much.
We're going to have part two of this so we can more speakers.
Oh, I wish we did. We used to go on all night, sir. But all right, let's thank our speaker again. Thanks, guys, for doing the tech stuff. You know, I'll be eclectic as usual. We used to do, you're talking about Haymarket, for at least 10 years, we have a play that we perform every May Day on the Haymarket situation. Matter of fact, even today, I came across inadvertently, we have a bomb that we would theoretically, you know, but we were celebrating Haymarket when it really wasn't being celebrated, so to speak, or remembered would be a better term. Nevertheless, we saw that point. The reason we stopped doing it, we just got kind of tired of doing it every year thing. You mentioned Lucy Parsons there. I'll take credit. I got the park named for Lucy Parsons. I'll leave a lot out of this story. I got involved, actually I was competing against the Patrolmen's Association and had a website up. Park District thought we were going to have a riot at the meeting. And I lined up testimony. Bill Adelman spoke. I had women's history study people and things like that. And they thanked us. They said they never saw so much interest in the parks. They were really, they called me. They thought we were going to have a riot. at the Park District meeting, but I still have the website someplace. It grew and grew. Another little thing about the Wobblies in 19, there was the 100th anniversary there, and a gentleman here at the college and I were writing a play. We were going to put on a play commemorating the 100th anniversary of the Wobblies, and some of you may know the gentleman I was working with. It was J.J. Jameson. J.J. Jameson was apprehended because he had escaped from prison, and our project was just a little bit too difficult to do at the time. He had other things that were occupying himself. Also, that thing about the viaduct, you say, I've been there many times, I'm a railroad guy, I go down there, it's Martinsburg, West Virginia. This is a neat story. The strike began in Martinsburg, a little tiny town. It's the oldest continuously used station in the United States, or so they claim. But the strike began there and it went all the way up the line on the B&O Railroad. It went all the way and went up through Pittsburgh, Cleveland, and so forth, and ended up in 13th and Halsted here. But it was a fascinating strike, and all the men along the line joined in the union here. For some reason, I have Walmart written down here. I've never gone into Walmart. I have no intention of going into one. I don't feel there's, I don't know, can't find any intellectual basis for needing to go into one. We've had some evenings here debating that. A job at Walmart is better than no job at all. I guess that's what I've heard, you know. And that's, I remember we had the woman here. I said, you know, I'm opening up a coal mine in the south side. You know, and a job in Chuck's coal mine is better than no job, right?
There seems a coal
mine. You know,
there.
And you, sir, you've got the real distortion in history. And the unions came about, the Wagner Act was passed because the unions grew massive. Commies in 1935, it wasn't for cooperation, it's because they were afraid. And for the 12-year period, unions in the United States were, quote, legal. And when they got a little less afraid, they came to put the kibosh on it. And what's this talk about cooperation? And you say, you're making me, what's this stuff about union democracy? This is making, please, you guys are making me ill. I have on my desk a video called Teamster Boss. That's what I want to be. Not some Christian pastor. Listen, if I'm getting fired, I don't need the help of the Christian pacifist. You got your choice between him and the Teamster Boss. And you, young lady, if your union ain't no good, whose fault is it? Yours. You didn't raise your hand. When I took my job many, many years ago, they said, oh, we have a job in the union. I raised my hand 35 years ago. And you didn't raise your hand. You just sit back and go, well, the union don't do this, the union don't do that, the union don't do this. When the rest of us are running the goddamn union.
Speaker gets the last word, Charlie. Speaker gets the last word.
Good point, yeah.
Speaker gets the last word.
Get off your ass.
Larry's feedback.
All right, I got another hour, right? I got only got a couple things to say. I love this guy. You know, keeping it short. I actually found something to agree with in what every single speaker said. Every single one. And by the way, Lester Weir, one of the founders of the Labor History Society, is a lifelong member of the Henry George Society. And you know, but Pullman, of course, wanted the school named after him. So. For me, it's a privilege always to be able to address people about what I think is the way in which we can transform our society the most efficiently and the most effectively, which is by our collective association and our action, sometimes struggle, often cooperation, mutual respect, and recognizing that people should come before profit. And I think that we have examples of that in history, and it's the good examples of history that give us those lessons. And it's those lessons that if we can learn, and we all know the cliches about insanity is doing the same thing over and over again when it's not working. And I think that I speak from the institution of labor inside and outside, and from a historical lens, that I am optimistic. I believe that there have been many times when, after the Haymarket, after the 1919 Palmer raids, before the National Recovery Act, before the Wagner Act, after the Wagner Act, that I think while there's many reasons to believe Occupy will not sustain itself, it may also create an opportunity in other ways. We don't know. The College of Complex is about trying to think outside the box. It's what we need to do. We need to tell our story. We need to recognize that our own personal experience isn't necessarily everybody else's. We have a lot to learn from each other. I thank you. I hope you think about the Labor History Society being able to carry on into perpetuity the story of the history of why workers can, working people, we're all working people, have a mutual interest, and that it should be about fairness, and that there is dignity in all labor. When we recognize that and recognize that exploitation is the evil, we will be able to make a better world. We do that. History is showing that we're doing that, and I stand in support of anybody else who every day will speak up and speak out against the wrongs and fight for justice. That's the story I hope we keep telling.
All right. Thank you. All right, let's try some stuff.
Don't forget to set your watches ahead.
That's right. We've got to spring forward.
Let's
see a partner.
Yeah.